Today's date is June 26, 1996. The survivor is Marion Gottesman, maiden name Silverberg. The interviewer is Joe Bobro. We're conducting this interview in Rego Park, New York, in the United States of America, in the English language. Today's date is June 26, 1996. The survivor is Marion Gottesman, maiden name Silverberg. My name is Joe Bobro. We're conducting this interview in the English language in Rego Park, New York, in the United States of America.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Can you please tell me your name?
My name is Marion Gottesman.
Was that your maiden name?
No, my maiden name was Jutta Mariana Silverberg.
Can you spell both last names? Your current last name now?
My current last name is Gottesman, is G-O-T-T-E-S-M-A-N. And my maiden name was S-I-L-B-E-R-B-E-R-G, Silverberg.
Where were you born?
I was born in Flotow, in northern part of Germany.
Can you spell that, please?
V-L-O-T-H-O.
What large city is that near?
It's between Bielefeld and Hanover.
What year were you born?
In 1927.
So that would make you how old now?
Well, I was 2 days ago, I was 69.
Happy birthday.
Thank you.
What do you remember about your hometown?
It's a very small town, and I don't remember too good of things from even from before the war, because I was 6 years old when I started school in 1933, and we had a very, very tough time from the beginning.
Tell me about it.
Well, like I said before, I started school in 1933, and a half a year later, we had to sit in a Jew bank.
In the where?
On a bench only for Jewish children, in front of all the others. And there was a lot of anti-Semitism in the northern part of Germany, so we felt it from the time we were very little.
So you remember at the age of six already?
Yes.
Feeling.
Yes.
How about before 6 years old? Do you have any earlier memories?
I have memories from my family and from my grandmother, which I was very close with. And
let's start talking about
et cetera.
What was your grandmother's name?
My grandmother's name was Rebecca Silverberg, and she came from Krefeld, which is in Rhineland, and got married to her own cousin, first cousin, Israel Silverberg, which I don't remember. He died in 1926. And they lived in Flotow, and my grandmother, we lived with my grandmother for a while, in the end of it, before we got arrested. And I don't know, I guess a normal childhood, few Jewish people.
Memories of your grandmother.
My grandmother was a big, huge woman, very lovable, and always feeding us.
Was she a good cook?
Yes, very good.
What was your favorite dish that she made?
Offhand, I really don't know. I just know that she was a very good cook, and she always was interested that nobody should get hungry.
Were you very close to your grandmother?
Yeah, very close.
Did she do things together with you?
In those times, grandmothers were grandmothers. They weren't people who did things with you outside of the house, let's put it that way. And she just was a very lovable person.
What do you mean by she was a grandmother?
Not like here. You become a grandmother in America, you run around and do all these things you do when you're young, right? But over there, it's like, I guess it was like a normal way of grandparents or grandmothers at the time being the motherly types for the whole families.
And your mother, what was your mother's name?
My mother's name is Henny, was Henny Silverberg, and her maiden name was Strauss.
Can you spell that?
S-T-R-A-U-S-S.
What kind of a person was your mother?
My mother was a beautiful woman. She was very compassionate. She always tried to help people, and her profession was a nurse.
Did she work as a nurse outside of the house?
No, this was before she got married, that she was a nurse. She was at a university in Gießen, which is near Frankfurt, as a nurse there.
And your father?
And my father was a very, I don't know how to explain to, he wasn't only my father, he was my friend, he was everything to me.
What was
and
his name?
And I was everything to him, that I know.
His name?
Willie Zilberberg.
Willie?
Yeah.
You were very close to him?
I was very close, I was an only child. I was the daughter he wanted, but I also was the son he wanted. He made me grow up like a tough little kid.
What do you remember doing together with your father?
A lot of bicycle riding. We didn't have a car, so we went from one town to the other visiting friends and people he had business to do with. And yes, was my father.
Was he strict?
No. No, not really. Not really.
Did you get into trouble?
Oh, many times.
Tell me what would be a typical thing that you would do to get in trouble.
There was a boy I grew up with in the town, a Jewish boy, and the trouble we got into is that we come from a small little hilly town, and we found naturally the highest little mountain there. We would climb up there in dangerous positions and things like this, and just got out, you know, like little troubles.
And what would your parents do when they found out that you did these things?
They were glad we came home in one piece.
Tell me about the town itself. What did it look like? How large was it? How many people lived there?
When I was a child, now it became a bigger town because they incorporated a lot of small towns. It was a small town with 5,000 people living there. In what I remember, there were never more than 20 Jewish families in town. And little by little, in the beginning, some people moved and immigrated to the States or somewhere else. So by the time that I really remember, there were maybe 10 families left, the most.
Did you have Jewish friends or
yes,
non-Jewish?
Yes, I had this one boy, his name was Günther Katz, and he was survived also Auschwitz, etc. And he never came back to Floto. He was sent from Floto to Holland. From Holland he came to Theresienstadt, from Theresienstadt to Auschwitz. And when he was liberated, I don't know where he was liberated, the Russians took him to Odessa and flew him back to Holland. And from there in Holland he found out that none of his family except one aunt survived, and she was in Belgium. So she went to Brussels, he went to Brussels to meet her there, and then came to the United States, but he passed away here.
But you met him later on
in
the United States?
Yes, yes, yes.
You recognized each other?
Well, he got in touch with us. I don't know how come he got our address. I think he found out through one of the organizations that my mother and I were the only survivors who came back from Floto, and I believe that he got in touch with us already in 1946. We came here in 47, so we knew that he was in Brussels. And so we had each other's address, and we knew when he would come here.
Besides this friend, did you have many other friends?
The other Jewish children I was with, nobody survived. We were very close. It was a close little town friendships there. And the first transport went to Warsaw, so nobody came back from there. Then the transport went to Riga. They got killed there. And actually, the only ones who came back to the town was my mother and me.
But do you remember having a large group of friends when you were growing up?
Well, we were about five, six children there, not more than that. And they were different ages, you know.
You lived close by to each other?
Yeah, it was a small town, you know. You couldn't help it, you're close.
Did you have non-Jewish friends also?
I remember some non-Jewish friends, but they didn't last long because even if they wanted to be friendly, they weren't permitted. They couldn't.
What kind of games did you play as a child?
We built our little cars. We didn't have toys like nowadays, so we built us little cars and stuff like that. And
how would you build it?
We actually took wood and put like, I don't know, what do you call those little cars the kids pull and put things on. They have them here too, but they're
like
already
a wagon?
Toys. Yeah, like a wagon. That's what I meant with a car. We did things like that and got little wheels from somewhere, etc.
Anything, any other games that you remember?
No, not really. I mean, you know, like, I guess what every kid plays. I don't know. I really don't know.
Were you active in sports?
We didn't have an opportunity to be active. What I did is with all the boys there, I played soccer as a kid.
Were you the only girl?
I was the only girl left there because everybody else had, you know, left already. And the others were a little older. They went to different schools out of that town. So, you know, it was always with the boys.
Do you remember what kind of a student you were? Were you a good student? Was schoolwork easy for you?
I wasn't the best student, that's for sure. I didn't like school because, you know, like, we had one teacher who was very nice to us, who actually himself got into trouble because of us Jewish children. The other teachers were very bad at that particular time already. And we were glad when we got to school and got out of school and they didn't molest us outside, the kids, etc. And we're glad to get home. School was like not very pleasant those years. All the schooling I have in Germany really was from 1933 to 1938. And then after the Kristallnacht, nobody could go to school anymore. And then they had in another town, but by that time we were only like maybe three or four children left. I went into another town to school and the others went to Holland, and two of the children who went to Holland, matter of fact, they found out from relatives in Holland that the parents were in the transport to Riga, and they went over the border back to Germany to go with the parents. So it's like not the best times to remember before the war either.
What was your best subject?
My best subject, art.
What kind? Drawing?
Drawing, art. And literature, things like that, things I was interested in. It wasn't mathematics, that's for sure.
I was just going to ask, what was your worst subject?
Mathematics. But I believe it has something to do with the teacher we had, because for each subject we had different teachers, and that was the worst Nazi anybody could come across. So I think that had a lot to do with it, that I was afraid of him, and I didn't, you know, that mathematics was something to be afraid of.
You mentioned that the Jewish children had to sit on a special bench.
Yeah.
This was from the first grade you remember?
Shortly after the school started. I started in 33, so between 33 and 34 already at that particular town.
How large was the total class that you were in the classroom? How many children approximately?
I would think about 25, 30 children, maybe less. I really don't know.
And how many Jewish children?
We were two in our class.
So two out of 25, approximately.
Right.
And you had to sit next, it was you and one other person?
Yes, that was this boy I grew up with and who I met here again. We were sitting in front of everybody, and it was called the Judenbank.
Were you teased? Did they...
Oh, yes. My school memories are not the fondest and the nicest, believe me. We couldn't go for gym. We couldn't go for sports in school.
Why not?
Because we were Jews. When they had their gym lessons, we had to either go out of the school and wait outside, or the town was so little, for 1 hour we would go home and then go back. And the same thing was through... in music, too, because they had all the Hitler songs and etc., so we were not naturally not interested, but also not permitted to go for music. religion they had in school. We had to go out, so it was very little schooling, even in those years already.
You mentioned that most of the teachers also were not nice to you?
No.
You had one nice teacher.
We had one very nice teacher.
Do you remember that teacher's name?
Yes. I don't know his first name, you know, Mr. Albsmeyer.
What subject did he teach you?
German and geography, I believe, literature, things like that.
What would he do that made him nice? How, you mentioned he got in trouble, but...
I tell you something, he tried, when the German children started up with us, so he would take them on the side, he would take our side, leave them alone, this and that. So he got himself really into trouble already.
He tried to protect you?
Yes, he was very protective of us. I did meet him after the war when I came back to Germany.
You recognized
him? Yeah, well, I knew where he was, so I went to see him, you know, and he was naturally very glad that I came back. The only one.
He remembered you?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. I believe he was a teacher of my father in his last years of school, too, because in Europe it was that one teacher was there for so many years that even the parents went to school with them already, you know, something on that order.
The other teachers, yeah, you said that were not so nice.
Yeah.
What would they do that you remember that wasn't nice to you?
The mathematics teacher. Not only that he hit us, but he also, like when a teacher calls you and said, let's say to the blackboard, he wouldn't call us by our name. He would Jew girl or Jew boy or etc. So naturally that didn't leave a very good thing in us.
You mentioned he hit you.
He hit us. He did a lot. They did a lot of things to us. I don't, rather don't remember them.
Did he hit the other children also, or only you and this other Jewish boy?
No, he hit. No, some of the children were hit. This was a typical European, I guess, in schools to be hit. But he had it out for Günther and me. That's for sure.
He hit you more frequently and maybe
harder?
Oh,
definitely. Any excuse. Any excuse. You didn't need an excuse to do it.
And if the other children were bothering you, would he try to protect you?
No, he called us the very bad names and things like that right in front of the children. They fell right into it because that what they were taught in the Hitlerjugend, etc. So these are the memories of Floto schools.
How far away was the school?
Everything was in walking distance, but we walked about maybe 20 minutes, 15 to 20 minutes to go to school.
Who did you go to school with?
Miss Günther.
He stopped by and picked you up?
Yeah, they lived a few blocks away from us, and we went together, and his brother, who was a year older, it was in another class, and that was it. His brother didn't survive. He went to Auschwitz and didn't come back.
When you walked to school,
yeah,
were you safe? Was anyone bothering you?
They were bothering us. They were calling us names and things like that. And even some of the parents of the children did that also. So
did
that was Germany in those times.
Did they physically hurt you in any way?
Many a times. Many times when we were kids. We got beaten up in the streets and things like that. But it was a way of surviving and living then already.
When you came back home and told your parents what happened, what would they say?
They were terribly upset because they couldn't do anything. I remember that at one time I got into a fight with three boys on the street.
Three against
you? Three against me. And I was always taller and bigger than Günther, so when they started in with him, I fought his battles at the time too. And from one of the boys, the father was a friend still at that particular time of my father, right? So he must have seen the whole thing. I was like 7 years, 8 years old. He took me and brought me home, right? But his son was the one who beat me up. So this was like one of those things.
How badly were you beaten up?
Well, sometimes we got beaten up bloody, got blue marks. got away with it. That's it. We were little.
Did you always try to fight back?
Yeah. I was a fighter all the time.
And how about Gunther? Did he fight back?
He would have been a fighter if he was bigger. He was, matter of fact, he was born in 1926, so he was a year older than me. And he was so tiny at the time when school started for him, which would have been a year before, that they didn't take him, because not because of that he was Jewish, that he physically was not fully developed as a six-year-old one should be. So that's how come he started the school with me, and then he became a very strong man later on, when I was all six.
What language was spoken in your home?
German.
Any other languages?
No. No.
Yiddish?
My parents spoke a little French. They had friends from France who lived at a particular time in Germany. But the only thing I really heard was German. No Yiddish.
Did you celebrate Jewish holidays?
We celebrated the holidays. I'm not from a religious background, but we had a synagogue and had, I don't know if it was a cantor or a rabbi, we called him rabbi, and for the holidays we would go to shul.
Do you remember the rabbi's name?
Yes, we had Herr Heller, Mr. Heller, Max Heller, and he left just before the war and came here to the States. And then later we had somebody, Mr. Lazarus, I believe was his name. Yeah, Lazarus.
Did the temple have a special name?
No, just was a synagogue in Florida. Florida synagogue. I don't know if it had a name, I don't remember.
Was there just one synagogue?
Yeah, yes. As a matter of fact, it was quite a big synagogue for a small little place like that with so few Jews living there. But in that area were a lot of resorts, and in those resort areas just happened not to be many Jewish people living there, so they came for the holidays to Florida.
What was your favorite Jewish holiday?
My favorite Jewish holiday? Passover.
Why?
Because there was wine on the table. But as children we didn't get any wine, so my mother made some kind of a fruit juice at the time and told me that that was mine. And usually Günther and his brother came over too, and we had Passover together, and with his parents, naturally.
And you thought you were drinking wine?
We were thinking that we were drinking wine, and always thought we were shikha, which we were not.
And what does that mean, shikha?
Being drunk. That much Jewish I now knew then already. I mean, we had Jewish words which we used, I think, I remember, but not that we spoke really Yiddish.
Did the town have any parks or any rivers?
No, we had a river. We had a river, and as a little children we would go swimming there. But that later on we couldn't do that anymore either, so there were not many things we could do.
You weren't allowed to go?
No, we were not allowed to go.
By whom?
By the Germans, by the town, by the Bürgermeister. But
what would happen if you went swimming when you weren't supposed to go?
I think we maybe have gone swimming till 1937, 38, but after that was nothing. 1936 maybe. It was very hard. It was very, very hard. There was a movie which we could not attend to. There was a big sign up that Jews were not allowed to go in. And I remember my mother taking me to another town to see a movie, and in the middle of one of the movies it got dark. They turned off the screen and announced that there are Jews in the movie house and they should leave. So we had to leave in the middle of the performance. I must have been about, I think it was maybe 1936, 37 already. Because after 38 we couldn't even leave the town anymore. So it must have been in 1936, 37.
Were you and your mother the only Jewish people?
No, they were we were in a different town, so there were different Jewish people there. So everybody went out. That was way of life.
Didn't you think about just staying there, pretending if you were in a different town, how did they even know you were Jewish?
Because the towns are so small that every, you know, and so near each other that everybody knew. They knew. I mean, I was a child. I did what my mother told me to, and I walked out with her. And I remember meeting other people there, and my mother acknowledged them, and they acknowledged us. And then we took, I think, the train back home. That was it.
Do you remember the name of that movie?
I'm trying to. I think the English version would be Curly Head. Something like a child with curls. And I think the actress was a child actress, something like Shirley, what was her name?
Temple.
Shirley Temple was at the same time, approximately at the same time, right? Traudelstark, that I remember. And I think I must have wanted to see that movie, that maybe I read the book already or something like that. That was the movie I remember. That's the last time I went to the movie there.
Did you ever have a chance to go back to see that movie?
The whole movie? No, I never did. One of those.
What did your house look like, your apartment where you grew up?
Well, I remember three homes. The home where I was born, which was a very huge, large apartment, very modern furniture, you know, the Bauhaus type what they had in Europe at that time already in the 20s. And we moved from there.
What was the first address? Do you remember the name?
Herforder Straße 36.
Say that again, the name of the street?
Herforder Street 36.
And you moved from there?
From there.
When you were how old?
I must have been about 7 or 8 years old, because we had to leave that particular apartment. It wasn't my parents' house. We had an apartment there. And as a matter of fact, that Günther and his mother and father and his brother also lived in the same building, and they had to move.
Why?
Because we were Jews. That started very early there. And we moved to a different area in that small town, like from one end to the other town, but very close to each other. They had like a apartment few houses down from where we lived. And it was a smaller apartment. But, you know, when you're a child, you don't know any better. We had still our same furniture and everything. And from there...
How long did you live there at the second apartment?
Let's see, from 1936, 37, around that time, 36, till... end of 1937.
So about a year, a year and a half?
Maybe a year and a half, 2 years, something like that. I don't really remember the, you know, numbers of anything. And then we moved to my grandmother's house.
We're going to have to stop the tape now, but we'll resume in just a moment.
Okay, fine.
This is tape number 2. My name is Joe Bobrow. The survivor is Marion Gottesman. We're doing this interview in Regal Park, New York. and today is June 26, 1996. We were talking about moving from one end of town to the other end.
Right.
Do you recall the name of the street where you moved to?
From Herforder Straße, we went to Lange Straße 20. And we were a few years living there, and then we went to my grandmother's house. We had to live with my grandmother together.
You had to move out again?
We had to move out again because there was not only laws, even the people were afraid to have Jews as tenants. That's when we had to move again.
Mm-hmm. Where did you move to? Your grandmother's house? Where was she living?
She lived in Lange Straße 81.
Was that close by?
That Lange Straße is a long street. It's, you know, translation would be long street. Went from one end of the town to the other end. So my grandmother's house was in the center. That way.
And did your friend move also?
Yes, because right across the street from my grandmother was the temple, was the synagogue. And there was an apartment in there. And that's where the family cuts moved to. The boy Günther I talked about and his family.
They lived in the temple?
It was the temple, and in front of the temple was like a little house. I guess it used to be for a caretaker or something like that. And they moved in there.
Do you remember how you felt being forced to leave one place
and really.
The other place?
I don't remember things like that. Just now it was a fact we had to leave, and I was very happy to move into my grandmother's house to be with my grandmother all the time.
So it didn't upset you?
No, that I don't remember that. I don't think I was upset about it.
And your parents, do you remember how they felt?
Well, my parents felt different about it, naturally, but on the other hand, my grandmother went on in years already, so they were happy to be with my grandmother together and could take care of her also.
And you were allowed to continue living with your grandmother for a while?
No, till the end, actually, till we were arrested. But the other thing is that the other few Jews who were still there and had homes, they had to give up their homes. And there were two Jewish houses, which one was the Silverback house, which was my grandmother's, and the other one was right next door, which was the Heinemann house, the name was Heinemann. And everybody had to move together in the two houses. Actually, they were one family, or let's say, not two family houses, but big one family houses. And we had in my grandmother's house was my grandmother, us, and three other families. We all had to move together. So it turned out that some people had a kitchen together, tried to have a little room as a living room, private, and a bedroom. And those houses were quite big. Not the rooms were not that big, but the houses were big. So in the one family house what my grandmother had, we ended up living there with three, four families.
Do you remember the names of the other families?
Yes. There was a mother with her daughter Mosheim, and a family Grundmann. And then from the Grundmann and Mosheim, they were somehow related, the old grandfather, Mr. Mosheim, he also lived there. So actually it was like four different parties. Three different parties and us and my grandmother.
Did that affect you at all? Did that bother you?
It didn't bother me. I was happy that they were there because the family Grundmann happened to have a lot of books, like a little library. And I enjoyed that because all of a sudden I had all the books I wanted to read.
And how old were you about at this time?
I would say I was 38, I was 11. I must have been about 11, 12 years old. 11.
How did your parents feel about other people living in your grandmother's house?
In one way, they were glad that we didn't have to move again. And the other way, it was a way of living, we had to. Personally, how they personally felt about it, I really don't know.
We didn't talk too much about your father. What did he do for a living?
I believe you call that a tanner here, the people who make from skin leather. He was in that type of business.
Did he own his own business?
No, not that I remember him owning the business, but my grandparents had that type of business also, but not anymore at the time, you know, during the war, before the war, like right after, you know, 33 when Hitler came. So my father was getting skins and would bring it to the tanners, and they made leather out of it. That's how I remember.
Would he go out to try to sell the leather then also?
No. That was an, and as a matter of fact, I think there was a Jewish business in leather, and he would sell the skins to them. But at one time he had it, but I don't remember it. He had his own business, but I don't remember that. He also was a very sick man because he was wounded in 1914-18 during the First World War. And
he was in the military?
He was in the military, yes. Like all the German Jews were those years. And he had the, I believe, a gas poisoning of some kind, you know, during the war in France or something. And he had the open TB from that. The lungs were affected with it. So he was a very sick man.
How did things start getting worse? What are your early remembrances after moving to your grandmother's house and other people living together with you? Were there restrictions? You mentioned you were not allowed to go swimming.
There were a lot of restrictions. There were no children left at that particular time except that one girl, Mosheim. And they, I don't know for what reason or how come, they moved to Hanover. The others stayed in our house, but they went to Hanover. And so I was the only child, and in that particular time, nobody could leave the town. And then they started a school, the Jewish school, in Hereford, and I had to go to the Jewish school. But also, at the same time, we got the Jewish star already to wear. So nobody could get out of the town but me. I had a pass to go on the train or on the bus to go to Hereford to school. So with that, I got acquainted with other people in Hereford and also with some Christian people there, and I brought food home and things like that.
You mentioned you had to wear a Jewish star.
Yeah.
Can you describe what it looked like?
A yellow star, Jewish, like a Mogen David, like a Jewish star, and it said Jude, yellow and black.
Where did you have to wear it?
On the left side of your jackets or outer garments.
How did you feel wearing it? Do you remember your feelings about it?
Yes, that I do remember, because in the train where I went, at that time, at one particular time already, they had French prisoners in that area. And the French prisoner of war also was transported on those trains to go to work. So they saw me, and they tried to talk to me and gave me candies. I still was a child, don't forget. And you felt different. You felt different. I have to say that.
Were you proud to wear the star? Were you ashamed to wear it?
What, I never was ashamed to wear it. I was afraid to wear it at times, but I never was ashamed.
Did it cause you any problems by wearing it? Did you?
Yes, it did cause me problems, because at one time I had, I don't know if you're familiar with it, when you had relatives in the States or anywhere out of Germany and you wanted to write to them, you got a little slip at the post office which you bought and send it along in your letter, and they could get American stamps for it, for instance, right? So I was the only one who could get out of town. I used to go to the post office in Hereford and got those little things. I had to buy them for my parents. And I remember very well one time I was two men came over to me with their badges out, and they were Gestapo then already.
With the what out?
Gestapo, you know, like little passes that they were from the Secret Service, German Secret Service, what, I don't know what you would call Gestapo, right? And I had to open up my books and everything what I had with me for going to school, because they were thinking that I had things in there. And so I had...
They were searching you.
Yeah, they were searching me then already.
That must have been frightening, wasn't it?
Very frightening. Very frightening. Very frightening. So this was already before they arrested us.
We're still talking about the period before you were arrested. Yeah. Any other memories of... How about kindness? Mm-hmm. Did anyone show you kindness? Any non-Jews?
Some friends my father had, because he was born in the town also, so he grew up with all these people. Even if they didn't show to you outwardly, but they would come at night and brought like food and stuff and would hide it on the side of our building. You know, so that type of kindness we came across occasionally.
Were there food shortages during this time?
Yeah, then already, because they had the food stamps, like, you know, to get food, not
rational cards,
right? And Jews, of course, got less than the others, much less. So we were lucky that my father had some friends in that town.
Do you remember being hungry?
In Germany?
Before you were arrested?
No, not really. Not really, I would lie. No.
Was your father still allowed to work during this time?
He didn't work for quite a lot of years. And then there came a law out that I don't remember anymore exactly when it was, 37. Everything was around 36, 37. That every German factory had to employ some Jews, because they wanted the Jewish business people to get out of business, and that they had to work in other factories, etc., in German places. And that time my father started working also in Herford, where I went to school, but this was before actually I went to school there. And this was 37, 38. And what happened is, what was the question again you asked me about my father?
If your father was still allowed to
work
in his
occupation.
Yeah,
no, he worked there, but on a very small salary, I remember that. So, this was also already that he had to work there. And Günther's father worked in another factory, and I don't know what he did, I forgot already, really. And then there were... there was one, the small times, the ones who lived then in our house, they had a paper factory, a huge big paper factory there, so a lot of people were employed there, but they took away the factory then already, so they were very mixed up times.
Did they pay him for taking the factory?
I don't know, I have no idea, I really don't know. I know that the factory was there till 1938, till the Kristallnacht. So, there's so many different things. I don't know if they did get paid or if they didn't get paid or whatever happened. And none of that family came back either, so they're the ones who went to Russia.
This Jewish school that you went to?
Yeah.
Did you enjoy that school?
Yeah, in a way I did, because I was with other children together again.
Did
that
it have
was
a name?
The main part. Pardon me?
Did it have a name? What was the name of the Jewish school?
No name, nothing. It was one classroom. And we were about maybe, I don't know the pictures, that we weren't even 10 children, maybe 10, 12 children, the most. And each one had a different age group. But we had somewhere to go and somewhere to be.
And the teacher was kind to you?
Yeah, very nice. He was the cantor of the synagogue, He was also a teacher.
Do you remember his name?
Levine.
Levine.
Yeah, Mr. Levine. I don't know his first name.
And he taught you all the subjects?
Yeah, he tried to teach each child actually individual, because we all had different knowledges from school, because we were different ages. But he made the best out of it. We learned something.
Yeah. Even mathematics?
No, not to me. That's the worst for me still today. I don't even know if we had mathematics at the time. It wasn't a school where it was real curriculum or anything like that, that you had.
Were your parents worried about you leaving, going to a different town by train?
They were very worried about it, and on the other hand, they were happy because I was the only one who could get out of town. So when they had any kind of connections, I was the little middleman in between already.
How long did this continue, going to the school?
To school, they closed that up and the transport started to Warsaw and to Riga, etc. So it must have been in 41, to 41. 40, what? To 40, because from 40 to 41 I worked already.
Are there any other memories that you'd like to talk about or any thoughts?
From that particular time?
Before you were arrested still.
I don't know what to say. In one way, how I feel about it is I was still with my mother, my father, and my grandmother. We were still a family. So.
Did you feel scared yourself? Were you nervous?
I don't think I ever was scared then, as a child, really. I don't remember the feeling of being scared. That came much later.
But at this time, you felt
no.
safe, more or less? You didn't
I didn't feel safe, but it was a way of not knowing better. I didn't know really a normal time as a child. It was always something.
Did your family ever talk about leaving Germany?
Yes. We wanted to leave in the worst way, but we could not leave because my father was sick. They didn't let anybody out with open TB, number one. And I had an uncle living in St. Louis, who was the son of my grandmother we lived with there, who came in 1898 to America. I think his uncle came and took him along. He never came back to Europe. And I remember my grandmother always saying, her son would never let her, you know, let down. She can go and move to America. But he never gave us the visa to go. You know, you needed a certain amount of money from the States and et cetera. We couldn't leave. Not everybody was well enough or rich enough to go.
Did she request his assistance to provide the necessary affidavit and documents?
No. And I let him know after I came back. When I came here to America, he came to New York to see me. And I told him, I said, I could understand that he couldn't do anything for us. But he should have tried. Not that my grandmother would have been alive at the time. Was old already, but she didn't have to go through that. You have a son in the States, you could have tried in the worst way in the early 30s already to get out.
And what did he say? Why he didn't try?
He was, I believe, in St. Louis, a baker. Now, I don't know if he had his own bakery or he worked for somebody or whatever. And all right, there was a depression and everything, but there were Jewish organizations then already. He could have at least tried.
You don't feel he did try at all?
No, not at all. And that I really found out also from my cousin who I met here again, who is the son of my father's sister, who came here in 1936, 37, around that time. And he was about 15 years old at the time. Now, he came with the children transport. And then was in an orphanage here, I believe, in New York for a few weeks or something like that. And then when it was known that there is an uncle and family in St. Louis, they got in touch with him and he went to St. Louis and stayed with them. But what I found out, that my uncle got paid for him from a Jewish organization to have a foster child. And then my cousin also told me that he took in other children to get paid for it. So I don't know the circumstances, how well off they were or not, but they could have tried to get my grandmother out. That's the way I feel.
Tell me again the name of this uncle. What was his name?
Benno Silverberg. Benno, B-E-N-N-O.
And your cousin, Rebecca, who lived with him?
Guy Stern, and he became a very famous man. He's a professor at Wayne University, and we are very close.
Anything else before we come to the period that you were arrested that you want to mention?
Not that I can really think of it.
All right. Let's talk about the arrest. What happened?
What happened is that we were the last Jews left in Floto because the other transports went already and they took most of the people. And it was actually my mother, my father, my grandmother, and the family Heinemann, which I mentioned before, which were two people who were in their 80s. My grandmother was in her 80s. That old Mr. Mosheim I was talking about, he was in his 80s. And my mother and father and me, we were the young ones. So that was the last transport out of Floto. And they came with trucks and SS and police, etc., and put us on the wagons, on the trucks, and took us to Bielefeld. And in Bielefeld was the next big town to us. They had what was called the Sammellager, you know, like where they collect a collection of people, the center. And then they took us to Theresienstadt. And that was, I looked up in the papers, I thought it was July 1st, 42, it was August 1st, 42.
That you arrived
in Theresienstadt? That we arrived in Theresienstadt.
Did you know where you were going?
A friend of my father's came from Czechoslovakia, was for one reason or the other in Czechoslovakia, but he was not Jewish, a non-Jew. And he had left a note for my father, we didn't even have a telephone at the time or anything, to come to his office. He was a dentist in a different town, in Bad Oeynhausen. So my father got himself like a little pass that he could go to Oeynhausen for his teeth. That's the way to get out. And he told him that in Czechoslovakia that they emptied out one big town and it's a ghetto for Jews in the eastern Czechoslovakian area and also for a lot of old people from Germany. And he even told my father at that time if there would be a way of getting me out, to try to get me out of Germany, but it was too late.
Do you remember this friend's name?
Yes, Dr. Fenker, Kurt Fenker, I believe. Dr. Kurt Fenker, V-E-N-K-E-R,
Dr. Fenker. So he tried to warn
he
your family?
He warned my father, yes. And we saw him again after the war, my mother and I. And we came back, we naturally went to him to see him.
How did they come for you? You mentioned a truck.
Yeah, they came in.
Did they physically force you out of the house? Was there? How did
we
it happen?
We had, there was physically, of course, physically, because we had to get on the trucks. They told us like a day before to get a certain amount of things we could take along, like clothing, etc. And my grandmother was 81 years old at the time. And I never forget she said when she stepped out of the house, she said, "This is the house where I bore all my children, and now they let me go. I have to leave." You know, this, the a matter of fact, what I found out about 3-4 years ago is that that particular house, the Silverberg house, was already in the 1600s registered under the name Silverberg. So the great great grand parents must have had it already. So it's like forced out of everything.
Do you remember what you took with you? Did you have to decide a choice?
Yeah, a choice of, I don't know, two dresses and two sweaters and two skirts or pants. I don't remember. I really don't exactly know what we took along. We did have most of the things we didn't get anyway. So it didn't matter what you took along.
So you remember going on this truck?
Went on that truck, they took us to Bielefeld, and from all the towns around there was like a collection camp there.
How long did you stay in this camp?
Maybe 2-3 days. Did
they?
More than that.
Did you have food to eat there?
They gave us something to eat, that I remember. Soup or bread or whatever. It started then already. We weren't surprised at anything then already. Didn't know what it was ahead of us, but a real surprise it wasn't anymore.
You weren't expecting anything wonderful?
No. No, not at that point.
And your friend, you mentioned this boyfriend, was he with you?
No, he was in Holland already. He was sent in after the Kristallnacht. They had family living in Holland, so the whole family went to Holland. And I saw him the first time again in Theresienstadt. He came in from Holland. That was Camp Westerbork, you must have heard of it. And he was in Westerbork in Holland, and then from Westerbork they came to Theresienstadt.
What do you remember about Kristallnacht?
The funny part is everybody says it was on the 9th of November. I remember it on the 10th of November. So it must have been the 2 days, the 9th and the 10th. We were in school, and there was one of those gym lessons or whatever had sessions there, and we had to leave. So we went home. We were on the way home. And the closer we came to our house, we saw a crowd of people already in front of their house, in front of my house, our house. And my mother and my grandmother were standing outside, and that was the time when my father was working in Herford. And the people who, the old people who still lived in the house there, they were outside, and all what we heard was screaming, and the SA, you know, in the yellow uniforms, the ones. Outside, and they broke everything in the house.
You mentioned ghetto uniforms. Who
not ghetto, I said SR uniform. SA, that was the yellow uniforms. They had, not the SS had the black uniforms and the gray ones. These were the SR, I think, were the stormtroopers.
These were German,
the
German
the
soldiers?
Germans, right. So
and
they
what
destroyed
were they doing?
The whole,
they were
destroyed the whole house inside, completely. Furniture, baths, everything what we had was destroyed. I mean, from then on, we really lived in broken up pieces already, till they took us.
And this is when you were still going to your public school?
Right. That was the last day of school, German school.
Did anything happen to the synagogue?
Yes. They didn't put it on fire. They broke it up. I think I have pictures in the album that I can show you.
Did they hurt people?
They arrested. They arrested all the men, mostly all the men. Some were sent to Buchenwald and Auschwitz, Buchenwald and Dachau at the time. A few came back, a few did not come back already. And a younger man, I remember, his name was Ernst Warschauer. He was married to one of the Grundmann girls in our house. And they arrested him, and he went to Dachau, and they were notified that he died there, or he got killed in Dachau then already in 1938. That's another story.
We're going to take a break now.
Okay.
And we'll begin tape number 3 in just a few moments.
Okay.
This is tape number 3. Today's date is June 26, 1996. My name is Joe Barbaro. The survivor is Marion Gottesman. We were talking about Kristallnacht and your memories of that.
Yes.
Is there anything else you'd like to say about that?
No, I only can say that when we got back to my house, everything was like, at that particular time, the SR, whatever, the Sturmtruppers and the Germans were there to destroy the houses. And my mother grabbed me and my grandmother and Mrs. Katz, Günther's mother, and the two boys, and we started walking towards another town. And on the way there, she went into a farm. There were like farmlands around there, and asked the farmer if she could make a phone call to Hereford, to my father in the factory, and let him know what, wanted to ask him what to do. So she got my father, they called him on the phone, and my father told him we should stay there. We were outside and my mother was in the farm. She should stay there for a few minutes. He's trying to get somebody, to call somebody and get his advice. He had a Christian man who was in some kind of a office in Hereford, which had to do with the veterans of 1914-18. So he must have been a friend of my father. I forgot the name. And my father called him and called my mother back over there that we should try to get to Hereford and go to that particular office. And he will be there. My father would be there. So it took us like at least 4-6 hours to get there. First we had to walk to the town where we could get the train and then etc., etc. Well, anyway, we got to that office. My father was there, and he closed off the office and told us not to leave. He would bring us food, and he will be in contact with somebody in Floto, and when everything is over, he would make sure that we get transportation back to Floto. And that this way, my father didn't get arrested, because everybody else got arrested. Günther's father got arrested, too.
On Kristallnacht.
On Kristallnacht. All the men most often went. So we came back, this was on the 10th of November 1938, and we were hiding out in this office there. And the next day, I don't know, remember exactly, but I believe there was some kind of a car that they took us back to Floto. And life continued. There was no schools after that and no work for anybody. And it was just a waiting period of time to 1942. A lot of people tried to get out from Germany. Still they went to Holland, not that it helped them very much. Some tried, like I mentioned, that one family who moved to Hanover, and some other people tried to get to Hanover and made it, but then none of them came back anyway. They all were arrested way ahead of us and sent away and didn't return, didn't survive. So that's the story till 1938.
From 38 to 42, just time?
I had to go to work in Hereford. I remember that after the Jewish school was over, because the Jewish school only started in 39 to 40. And in 1941, I worked in Hereford. I had to go to work because there were a law that all Jewish girls who had no school, no more school or anything, had to work and were sent to Berlin at the time. I don't know if you ever heard of that, the Simmonswerke. There was already something for the war things.
What was the name of the factory?
Simmons.
Simmons.
Yeah. And that was in Berlin. And my father also, through that man in Hereford, got me a job by a seamstress, and I had to work for her. So I still could go out of town. I was the only one who went back and forth out of town. And then the seamstress was, I believe, Jewish, and she was arrested with her father before us, so that was over. And I remember my father paying somebody for that, that I could go to work in Hereford and was not sent away. And what happened is that when those first transports went to Warsaw, the seamstress was in there with her father. And then I stayed in Florida, just, you know, around, hanging around and doing things with my mother and father, whatever, I don't remember. And then we were arrested.
Let's go back to that time you were arrested.
Yeah.
And you were brought by truck.
Trucks.
To this meeting place.
Right, in Bielefeld.
Interim place.
Town. Like a collection center.
How many people were in this collection center?
I really don't know.
Was it crowded? Do you remember?
Yes. First of all, it was crowded, and it was like then already laying on the floor with, you know, no beds or covers or anything. And we were there for 2-3 days, and then they took us to Theresienstadt.
Was this an outdoor area or inside?
No, it was inside. It was called Kiefhäuser Kaserne. You know, Kaserne is like for soldiers.
Like a barracks?
Like the barracks, right. And this was called the Kiefhäuser Barracks. That's how I remember it.
But they did feed you, you mentioned, right? There was food?
I think we got bread and soup. I don't know. I really don't remember.
They treated you not so bad? Was it, do you remember any?
It was bad enough. I mean, I don't really have a real collection of what happened. Everything was sort of trauma, you know, like you didn't know what would happen to you.
But you knew where you were going.
Yes, they told us we'd go to Theresienstadt.
And what were you expecting? What did you anticipate?
I don't know. I don't know what we anticipated. We had no idea what would be what, really.
Did they tell you it was going to be for resettlement or for working?
Well, they were talking about older people and sick people concentrating in Theresienstadt in the ghetto, which to us sounded better than going to Poland to the east. But even then we didn't know what it meant to go to the east, really. I mean, in details, what to expect.
Were you already aware of what was going on in other parts?
Yes, we knew. But I don't think anybody really expected what was coming and what had hit a lot of people already. Like, I had family who went to Warsaw. I had friends from Florida who went to Lublin. My uncle and my aunt from Krefeld went to Lublin. And I remember us getting postcards from there. But we still didn't know. We still had no idea what really was going on.
What would they write in these postcards?
The postcards, I remember one card. There were certain things which I didn't want to eat as a kid. And it was now the whole family knew I wouldn't eat this, right? So my aunt and uncle on the card wrote, Marianne would be very happy if she could sauerkraut again. If she could eat sauerkraut again over here. So that meant, as they had made out with my parents, like, a word to mention if things were bad. So this must have been one of the things that I would be happy even if I could get that to eat.
And that was one of the items that you did not want.
That's one of the items I never would eat.
So it was like encoded language.
Code, yeah, they must have made out a code what to write.
But you didn't know really how bad it was, right?
No.
They weren't allowed to write
idea.
That.
No idea. No. That was the camp Itzbika, Lublin. I don't know, Ibiza or Itzbika, Lublin, so it was
so
one of those.
After a few days of waiting in this transit area,
yeah,
in these barracks,
yeah,
what happened next?
The next thing is they put us on trains, and we were 2 days and 2 nights on the train going to Theresienstadt with hardly any food, nothing to drink. And the worst thing is to have thirst and nothing to drink. That was then already. That was bad, and it was in the summer. And it must have been very hot at the time. And we were so thirsty. And the train stopped in Leipzig, in Germany, before going over the Czech border there. And there was, from the Red Cross, were women walking around to the trains where the soldiers were on, etc. So we asked them for water. And they told us they don't give anything to Jews.
The Red Cross said
that? The Red Cross, the German Red Cross. And they have, you know, in Leipzig, in Dresden, they have a very funny way of talking German, the way they said it. You know, like we always imitated them afterwards.
What kind of train was this? Was it a regular passenger train?
There were regular passenger trains going to Theresienstadt.
You had regular seats? You were.
Well, it was very, very overcrowded, you know, like a lot of people in the thing. But there were seats and things. I don't really, you know, remember in those trains you had like side walkways with the windows. So it was very, very crowded in there.
Were there guards that were watching
you? Yes, they had the SS guards right there. With us on the train.
With guns?
With guns.
And nothing or very little to eat, you said, for 2 days?
Very little to eat. I don't remember what we had to eat. If we took that along or if they gave it to us in Bielefeld to take along, I have no idea. I just know there was nothing to drink. And that thirst, you know, like you wanted to drink some water or couldn't get anything.
How were the people treated during the train ride? Was there any problem?
You heard occasional screaming from other wagons, you know, and things like that. But I don't really, you know, I don't really recall it. I really don't know anymore exactly how that ride was from Bielefeld to Theresienstadt. I remember the other one going to Auschwitz.
You were with your mother, your father?
I was with my mother and my father and my grandmother.
And you were sitting close together?
Yeah, we were huddling together somewhere.
And the train finally stopped?
And the train stopped, and at that particular time, the trains didn't go into Theresienstadt. They went into Auschwitz. This is where supposedly the train ended, and then you had to march into the ghetto. They marched us into the ghetto.
Do you remember that?
Oh, yeah, I remember that very well.
How far?
A lot of people. I don't know how far it was. I don't know, at least an hour away from there, and I don't know how long it took us to get there.
And you had your suitcases with you?
We had like what they call a backpack.
Backpack,
knapsack, something like that. And I really don't remember much taking along.
Was it difficult for your grandmother to walk?
Oh, of course. She hardly could walk anymore for years already. We had, you know, schlepped her. We got her there.
Did everyone make it?
I don't know. I really don't know. There were so many people on the train, and I really don't, you know, from different cities and everything.
But you finally made it?
Made it to Theresienstadt.
And what did it look like? Well,
Theresienstadt looked like, I guess, like an army town at that particular time, because there were like, I don't know, not the word garnison.
Garrison,
right? It was a garrison from Maria Theresa, those years. And they built that in Czechoslovakia from, you know, the Austrian queen or whatever. Was, and there were only at one particular time were only military, so all the military and the people who lived there were out, and in all the houses they were full of people already, I mean overcrowded there. And
did you pass the civilian population, the German civilians?
No. German civilians or
to the Theresienstadt ghetto?
No. I don't know how they got us from Auschwitz into Theresienstadt, but didn't see any civilians at all. One of those six.
Tell me again about what Theresienstadt looked like. Was it a large area?
It was a large area, and it was surrounded what we call the Bastei, which is like a wall around it. Like I said, like a military town type of thing.
It wasn't actually a wall?
It was like a round wall going around it.
Made
on
up
top on top was grass, right? And underneath were like cellars. That was the surrounding of Theresienstadt. And in the center, there was a church. On each side of the church were two big houses. One of them I lived later on. They were all little yellow houses, buildings, you know, like an old European town. That's how it looked.
And where did they take you and your parents and grandmother?
My mother, my father, and I got into a house which called the for war veterans from 1418, you know, the Jewish war veterans who were left. They made like a circled area there where they only put people like this, you know, like where one member of the family was a war veteran. And my father stayed in one room with about, I don't know how many people, and my mother and I and my grandmother, we were in another room, but in the same building. We stayed in another room. On the floor, we had no beds, we had nothing. This was early, I mean, for the ghetto, it was really early August 42, because the first Jews from Prague came in 42, in the beginning of 42, maybe late 41, I don't know. So we were actually one of the first German Jews who got there. Not the first, but one of the first German Jews. So we stayed there. It was terrible. It was horrendous. And very little to eat. We had to go to a barrack where they had the kitchens. And you got like a little metal part, which they called their S-top. And you got the soup and piece of bread and whatever.
Was it enough?
No. It wasn't enough, but that's what we had.
Do you remember feeling hungry there?
Oh, yeah. In Theresienstadt, we were very hungry. Very, very hungry. And my mother befriended somebody. I don't know if you ever heard of him. He's very well known from Freddy Hirsch. Have you heard about him?
Tell me about him.
I just want to know if you ever heard about him.
There may be people that are not familiar.
Yeah. Well, he was a young man who lived in Prague, but originally was from Aachen, Germany. And I don't know how my mother met him or not. My mother started working as a, you know, like a helpless nurse or something, like to help sick people there. That's how she met him, I believe. And he was the one who started a youth group over there and put young children together into the houses surrounded by the church, those two buildings. And he told my mother that I should not be in the house with it, but I would be much better off if I would be with the younger children together. And that's how I got into that home there. We called it a Jugendheim. And unfortunately, I took very sick right away. And I was put in what we called a children's marotka, meaning a children's, like a hospital type of thing. We just stayed from September 42 till April 43.
Such a long time.
That long time. I had rheumatic fever. I was very sick. I couldn't move around. I was practically paralyzed. And I was very fortunate in one way. They had the Jewish doctors from Brünn and Prague, and they really saved my life.
Did they have medicine to treat you?
That's another story. They had medications which people had on them when they got to Theresienstadt, and it was taken away from everybody. And from that, they made like an apothecary center, like a drug center. And they had a Jewish man who was leading this whole thing and gave out the medication when it was needed. All right? And it turned out, if he would have been alive after the war, he would have been my father-in-law. And my mother had to go from where she worked to this particular place to get the medication. She worked, in matter of fact, for people with TB. Because she had the experience through my father, and there was like a little hospital, not a hospital, but, you know, like a room area where they only had TB patients. And that's where my mother worked. And she was sent from there to this big apothecary place, and Mr. Gottesman, who was my father-in-law, was the one who gave out the medication. And when she told him that I was so sick, that she must have been crying, whatever, that I was so sick and that I'm hospitalized, he gave her, I don't know what, glucosa. You know what glucosa is? Like a sugar from grapes, grape sugar, and they made liquids out of it, and people got that as, I don't know for what illnesses, as injections. And he gave my mother those whenever she went there and told her when she sees me to give it to me, to break it open and let me drink it, that I could drink it so it would give me energy. That's how we got into medication. Now there was very little medication for what I needed. And I was very lucky that one of the doctors from Brunnen, Dr. Schwartz, didn't survive it either, a young doctor, he was friends with a Czechnik is a Czech policeman who worked for the Germans in the ghetto. And this man would go back every week or every second week to Prague on a furlough. And this doctor told him to bring medication from Prague, if he could bring this and this medication. And I got that. And it really saved my life. That was the injections of a bee poison, which is specialized for rheumatic fever at the time. So this is how I made it.
And what was happening to your father during this time?
My father, believe it or not, I don't know what he was really working. I think he worked in a basement where they sorted potatoes. So he would steal potatoes, cook them, and bring them to the hospital to me. And then my grandmother was very sick. My mother took care till the last minute of her, and she died in February 1943. I still was in the hospital that time, so they came to tell me.
What did she die of? Anything specific?
I think she died of old age, number one, and hunger, and not being in a house, not being home, and not having her comfort that way.
And what was your reaction when your mother told you that she was?
It was very funny. I dreamt two nights before my grandmother died. I dreamt that my grandmother died, and when my mother and father came to tell me, I told them that I knew already. Now I break up. That's it. One of those psychic things, I think, can happen to anybody in life.
So it was no shock to you?
No, it wasn't. It really wasn't. It really wasn't. I knew it then already.
Were you reasonably well cared for in this hospital? This sounds.
It was amazing. It was amazing what these people did for me. Because if not for them, I would have died a long time before even anything else happened there. They really did. There were three doctors.
Yes. Three doctors?
Yeah.
And they all took care of you?
There were three doctors who individually took care of me. There were two doctors, actually all three of them were from Czechoslovakia. One was Dr. Schwarz from Brünn, and one was Dr. Hayek from Prague, and one was Dr. Sonnenschein, which was a woman from also from Brünn. And between the three of them, they tried everything and anything to take care of me and the other children over there. A lot of children died right next to me.
You saw children die?
Yes, yes, yes. Yes, I saw children die then already.
What would happen if someone died? Where was the body
taken? I remember waking up in the morning and the cot was empty. And I was told, oh, died during the night. It didn't mean anything. I mean, it was shocking for us children, but after a while, it didn't even mean anything anymore. Then I had one experience it was the early part of 1943. there was a transport going of very sick children to Auschwitz then already. We didn't know about Auschwitz, but we knew there was a transport going. And I was in there. I was in that transport already. And the doctors hid me. They had like a type of a closet, and they opened up the closet, put the cot in there, took the door out. No, they didn't put the door out. They left the door in and put a sign on the door, typhoid patient. So when they came to pick me up, you know, like with a cot to pick me up, they said, oh, this one has typhoid, you know, like that. So the doctor said, look, don't even take her along. She wouldn't even make it to the train station. That's how they saved my life. That was in 1943. I think it must have been in, I believe it was in February, January, in winter 43.
So when you recovered from your illness, what did you do next?
They sent me back to the home, which in between got very, very overcrowded because a lot of children came from Germany, from Austria, etc. And I got back in there, and little by little, when I felt better, I started to work like everybody else. And that was it.
How were the sanitary conditions?
The sanitary were very bad, but we tried to make the best out of it. I have to say that. I don't know where we found it. I mean, we stayed in line to go to the toilets. And in our room, we had a girl who was in charge of the showers, what we call showers, okay? And being that she was in our room, she naturally gave us extra time to do things, and when there was water and when there was heat, and you survived. You did things.
How many times a day were you served food?
I only remember, I think, once a day. I don't know if we had in the morning and at noon, or if we had in the morning and at noon, I think. We had a piece of bread and what they called coffee or whatever. And then in Dresdenstadt they had bread, and they had what we called Buchteln, that was like a cake type of thing. Instead of bread, you could get that. And what else was it? Soups. And then later on I worked in outside the ghetto, in the gardens and in the fields, so we stole things and tried to feed us that way.
What type of work were you doing after you got better?
First I was working in, they had like a repair shop for optical, like glasses, right, and things like that. And I was working in there. It was a Dr. Jelinek I worked for. He was an optical doctor and optometrist, right? And after that, this is actually the two jobs I had in ghetto, was what we called the Landwirtschaft out in the gardens, in the fields.
Was it good work?
Was hard work. Was very hard work, but everybody wanted to work like that because there was always a chance to get something to eat somewhere from the field, especially corn. We had what they call in the Czech kukuruz. Kukuruz is corn, the corn fields, and etc.
Were you treated okay? Was there any problem?
We had a Jewish girl who took care of us outside, and some men, and the SS was around. But we make a go of it, you know.
Were you mistreated at all?
I wasn't. Not there. I wasn't. I mean, I had certain experiences there because the one who took care of us out there had a way of telling us. We were in a field right near the Eger, which is a river in Czechoslovakia. And there were like big green bushes there. And then when she saw that some of the girls got very tired or so, she said, I'll lay down and sleep for a little while, or rest for a little while. So my one experience was there, that near Theresienstadt was what they called the Kleine Festung, the small It was really the concentration camp, not the ghetto, and which was very bad, which we didn't even know how bad it was at that time already.
We're going to have to stop okay. now, but All we'll right. continue with that in just
okay.
a moment.
Okay.
This is tape number 4. My name is Joe Barbaro. Today is June 26, 1996. The survivor is Marion Gottesman. We were talking about your assigned work in the fields, and
Hi.
You had a kind supervisor that let you rest in the trees and the shrubs
mm-hmm.
when you were tired. Do you recall that person's name?
I don't remember exactly her name. I believe it was Judith Peitzer. I could be wrong, I really don't remember, but I think that was her name. And my one experience was when she told me to rest, that the commandant from the Kleine Festung, which was the concentration camp part of Theresienstadt, not the ghetto part, was riding by with his horse, and I had the feeling that he saw me, so I had never, ever been afraid like that in my life. And I got away.
What would have happened if he caught you?
Well, I would have been dead immediately. I think he would have shot me, or I would have landed upright in the concentration camp there, and that would have been it, because nobody came out from Kleine Festung anymore.
How long were you working in the fields?
I think I was working there from the end of 43, something like that, middle of 43, I really don't remember, till I was sent to Auschwitz.
Before we get to Auschwitz, let's
yeah.
talk a little bit more about Theresienstadt. Was there a local organization in charge of the...
Yes, there was a Judenrat.
There was a Judenrat.
There was a Judenrat. We had a few different ones, I remember. Dr. Edelstein, who was one, and Murmelstein, and one was from Czechoslovakia, and one was from Vienna, and then there also was one from Germany. Now, I just know that Edelstein was the one from Brünn, and the other one was from later on from Czechoslovakia there, and one was also from Germany, but I don't know which ones they were.
And what was their function?
Their function was to elect people, number one, to go to the east and to Auschwitz when transports went, to hold the ghetto for the Germans together, to go after the German laws. And it wasn't an easy task, and I know two of them didn't make it out. I think one was liberated in Theresienstadt. I don't know which one it was, but I know Dr. Edelstein went to Auschwitz with a family transport before I did, and with the family, and that was I think Zucker was his name also, he was something in the, you know, in the Judenrat or whatever they called it, and...
Were these people appointed?
They were appointed from the Germans.
How did they determine who was going to be appointed?
I have no idea. I really have no idea how they did it.
Was this considered a good position to have?
Of course it was a good position, because you had your own rooms and you had your a different type of ghetto life than we had.
It was an easier life?
It was an easier life, but they went earlier than us to Auschwitz, and none of them came back. They were killed first once. They called the prominent to the other people. And there were transports going in 1943 and 1944. In 1944 mainly to Auschwitz with only prominent people on there. And it wasn't only from the Judenrat, there were other prominents also, you know.
How about a Jewish police? Was there?
They had a Jewish police. It was called the Ghetto Wache. And there were just men and women. A few of them were women, I believe. I don't know if they were women. I think there were a few women in the Ghetto Wache too, and the men, but they were just regular Jewish citizens who came from all over like we did, and then were appointed to work there as Ghetto Wache.
Was that considered a good
that
position?
It also was considered a better position, but most of them didn't make it anyway. So,
what was their function?
Their function was, we had, for instance, a curfew at night. A certain time, the whole ghetto had to be inside. Nobody could be on the streets and etc. So they had to make sure that nobody was on the streets. If they caught somebody, they would be arrested from the Ghetto Wache, and then the SS would take over, etc. They didn't have an easy task either, because it was like a Jew against Jew, and that really, really tried, most of them tried to be good, but it wasn't easy.
Do you remember any of their names?
From the Ghetto Wache, no, not really. I really, personally, I didn't really know anybody, you know, by name.
Was the surrounding area guarded to prevent people from trying to escape?
Yes. Yes, was all surrounded with a lot of uniformed SS with guns. Wherever you went, there, you know, you run into somebody in uniform, and especially when we went out of the ghetto. And this was our life there.
Did anyone try to escape?
I know that there was a resistance in Theresienstadt. There were two resistance groups. One was the called was Shaloma, which was the Zionist part of the resistance, and one was the Cheko, and that was for Czech communists, the left organization. And I personally knew some people who were in there, but I don't like to mention the name. One of them I know is here in New York, a friend of ours, but I don't want to mention the name. I spoke to him the other day to find a little more about it. And he is going in November to Terezin by invitation from the Czech government and the ghetto organizations there still in the museum. And he's going to give a lecture from the real inside of the resistance, which a lot of people don't even know about that it was going on. So they had people going out from the ghetto, and there was a time that in Czechoslovakia, in some of the villages that were Jewish children hidden, they still brought them to, from even some of the children, I believe, out of the ghetto to Yugoslavia, and from Yugoslavia to Italy, and tried to get them out. And there was a resistance there which really had hoped at one time that it could be like what happened in the Warsaw ghetto with a better success, but nothing happened.
Did they have weapons?
That I don't know. I can't say, I don't know. I surmise yes, but I don't know.
How about the first resistance group you mentioned, the Shalom?
The Shaloma.
Did you know anyone in that organization?
Yes. Yes, I did.
Can you talk about them?
I don't want to talk about it because I understand it was a very secret thing. And up to now, when people found out, that they came out with it, that it really existed, most of the people who were in Theresienstadt and liberated don't even believe it, because for the simple reason they didn't know about it. It was very, very secretive. And it really only came out like in the last few years. And I also know some people who were in the Cheko that was, a matter of fact, a very close friend of mine. And he made it out. He came to the United States and he died here a few years ago. So I rather don't mention names or anything.
I hope maybe sometime in the future.
I think we will be able. You know what? I believe that they're going to publicize this after November 1996, the whole thing, what really was going on, because this is what I understand the meetings are for now. I think it's on the 15th of November in Czechoslovakia.
So the main purpose was to smuggle out some of the children?
Yes. I understand a few children, they got out. They still got them to Palestine at that time, one way or the other. And they came back. And I know about one person, I don't know if you heard about Aaron Melcher. Him I can mention for the simple reason that he's from Vienna. And he was very, very well known in the Zionist organization. And he was called what they call in Hebrew, I think, a shliach. You ever heard that word? It's somebody who does for children and et cetera. And he was one who was also from Vienna bringing children back and forth and bringing children to Palestine and came back and returned. And he also came to the ghetto and went even, I believe, out of the ghetto and then returned and then was sent to Auschwitz. So there was a lot of things which a lot of people don't know about. But there's a book out on him, so his name I can mention.
Did you know him personally in
Yeah,
the camp?
I knew him too, yes. I did know him.
How did you know him?
I belong to a Zionist organization, but at that time, I didn't know it had anything to do with resistance or so. I mean, we were children.
What was the name of your Zionist organization?
We made our own organizations and we gave us names. Mine was the Haponim. Haponim. Yeah.
And this was while you were in the ghetto?
This was while we were in the ghetto.
Did you have meetings?
Yeah, in the rooms where we stayed, you know, like us girls and from the other rooms, the boys, we would come in, and we learned Hebrew, we learned the songs, we learned history. So any knowledge I have, I got it from over there, secretly. Yeah.
Was it an active group, active organization?
We thought it was active. We thought, I don't know how active we were in the Madrid and Madrichas, they were older than us, so they most likely somehow were more involved with everything than we were, what we didn't know about. But they prepared us that if we would be liberated to become really Zionists.
Were you hoping to go to Palestine?
Yes. Oh, are you kidding? That was my dream. To go, but then my mother and I came back together. My mother was very sick. I couldn't have gotten her out. And we came to the state. Sorry, I was told not to play with that.
Is there anything else that you want to talk about? Your experiences in Theresienstadt in the ghetto?
Ghetto. There's so much. I don't know where to start or where to end, really. Let's leave it at this.
Were you mistreated? Did you see other people mistreated in the ghetto?
I saw other people mistreated, but I wasn't.
How would
I saw
they
older
be?
People mistreated in the streets.
In what way?
That the Germans went through, and when they couldn't see the Jewish star, even in ghetto, we had to wear it. You know, they would hit them and all kinds of different things. I mean, it was mistreated already that people were hungry and didn't have enough food.
How many people were in this ghetto?
The ghetto was what we called a Durchgangslager. At one time there were thousands of people, and other times there were less people because the transport went and then came, you know, back and forth.
So it kept changing the number of people. Yeah. But it was crowded. Do you remember it?
It was
crowded.
Very, very crowded. Very, very crowded.
And most people were hungry.
Oh, and how?
Was there stealing of food?
I personally don't know. We stole food from the Germans, let's put it that way. But people, I don't know when they're hungry, if they take things. You never know. I mean, we were children and we got out and we did things still. We had a way of getting things, but try to get things.
Was there fighting amongst the Jewish people in the ghetto to try to get...
I don't know. I really don't.
Different apartments, more food.
Apartments you couldn't get. You just were in the room where you were. And more food, I don't know. I don't know.
These two resistance groups, did they occur at the same time or different periods?
It was all at the same time. I don't know how they were connected, because I know the Zionist group and I know the communist group were not really the best of friends at one time. But then I guess in the ghetto they connected. They must have been in existence already in Prague and in Brno.
I was asking before if anyone escaped.
I think they did. I don't know personally, but I think they did. From Theresienstadt. I think they did.
Was there any military form of resistance trying to attack some of the German soldiers or guards?
I think that was in the making. It was in the making of, but never got to it.
Why?
Because there were too many transport going already. Couldn't go ahead. Too many young people left, and the oldest ones were behind. The older ones were left behind. That's what it is.
Was there a fence or electrified wires surrounding?
No, like I told you, we had that wall which was normally built around the garrison town.
Were there searchlights around?
I don't remember.
What time was the curfew? You mentioned the curfew existed.
I'm not sure, but I think it was like about 7, 8 o'clock in the evening. Something on that order. I'm not sure. And then they also had a countdown every wherever you lived, what room you were in, or in a home, or in a building, or wherever people lived together, there was a countdown every day. They knew there were so and so many people in that building, and there had to be so and so many people in that building, you know, so.
Someone would come around to check how many people?
Yeah. That I know.
Were there marriages in the ghetto?
Yes, there were marriages in the ghetto, what they called the ghetto weddings. People got together and they got married. Most of them went individual or together to Auschwitz. Few of them survived, few didn't. I know of one who was together with me. She got married in Theresienstadt, a girl from Brno, and she went to Auschwitz with me and her husband also. I saw them again in Israel. They live in Israel now. And
what are their names?
Her maiden name was Tichova, Lili Tichova, and he was the Herbert Schwarzwald. And they changed their name in Czechoslovakia after the war when they met again. They changed the name to Sabotka, and they go under the name Sabotka in Israel.
And were there childbirths also?
Pardon me?
There were children born
in ghetto. A friend of mine, one of the doctors and his wife, had a baby in ghetto. And they went to Auschwitz and didn't survive. From that Dr. Schwarz, no, not Dr. Schwarz, it was Dr. Freud, Dr. Walter Freud. He was a Czech doctor with his wife who took care of the kids in the home where I was in. Not in the hospital. And he had a baby and went to Auschwitz again.
How old were you now in Theresienstadt ghetto?
Let's see, I left in 1942. I was 15.
Did you have a boyfriend?
Yeah, I had a boyfriend in Theresienstadt too, a Czech boy from Brno. And...
What was his name?
His name was Kurt Karner, and he went to Auschwitz to transport before me. His mother and his sister went with me to Auschwitz but didn't survive. Actually, they survived the selection. They were with us in the same barracks, but they didn't make it out.
But your boyfriend made it out?
I had never seen him again. After the war, I was still in Germany. I wasn't in Germany, I was here already in 1947. I met somebody who knew him, and knew him and me, and he told me that he's living in Prague. So we got in touch with each other, and we were riding for a while, but by that I was married already. And we rode for a while together. He had married and had a little boy, and tried to get out of Czechoslovakia at that time, which was very, very hard. And then later on, I found out, matter of fact, through that friend who was in the resistance, who was here in New York, that he came to the United States and lived here in New York, in Brooklyn somewhere. And he died about 4 years ago or something like that. I never saw him again. We never got in contact with each other here. One of those things.
Were there Jewish prayers in the ghetto? Were holidays celebrated?
Oh, yes, yes.
Were there rabbis or cantors?
There were the rabbis who were in Theresienstadt from different towns.
You were allowed to? Permitted to?
Don't know if it was allowed or not, but it was done. And I always see whatever we did included the lessons they gave us, you know, like schooling and things like that. I always had the feeling that the SS knew. But they also knew we wouldn't make it there, that we would be sent out anyway, the younger era. Now, with the rabbis, I know that they had services, you know, in different places, and et cetera.
Were there only Jewish people in this ghetto, or were there other nationalities?
Well, that's in question. I saw none in Theresienstadt. I don't know who she was and how she got there. I don't know what the nationality she was, but I saw her.
You don't remember her name?
I don't know her. No, I saw her, but I didn't know her. I saw her in the street. We had a girl who was, her name was Dolly. I forgot her last name. She was from the mountains from Austria. She was a couple of years older than us girls. So when we were like 16, 17, she was already 19, 20 or more. She was in the German army in Austria, right? And she wanted to become what it was called the flak, I don't know what it is, something shooting down the planes or tracking the planes. And she needed a special permit for that. And also the her father's name. No, she only knew her mother. She was an illegitimate child. And it turned out that her father was a Jew from Vienna. They arrested her, and she landed up in Theresienstadt, and she went to Auschwitz and didn't come back. As a matter of fact, my sister-in-law and I were always talking about her because we were friends with her. And we must have been the first Jew, I mean, not only us personally, but when she got to Theresienstadt, there must have been the first Jew she ever saw. She didn't even know anything. So people ended up like that too, you know. But I remember seeing the nun with the big cross walking around in her habit or whatever you call it. So she must have been arrested somewhere, and I don't think she was Jewish. I mean, that's...
Were there gypsies at all in this camp?
Not in Theresienstadt. We had, I was in a gypsy camp in Auschwitz.
How about
I shouldn't really say that because I know somebody who is here in New York, and his mother was a Jewish woman from Ostrau or Olmütz, and his father was a gypsy. And he and his mother and the sister came to Theresienstadt, and the mother survived and he survived. And the sister didn't come back from Auschwitz.
Did the gypsies have to wear any other identification? Not these.
Well, these people in particular went as Jews, right? Mm-hmm. But in Auschwitz, I don't remember. I really don't. I think we all looked alike, no matter what.
Anything else about Theresienstadt before we move on?
No, the only thing is with all the bad things and everything, I still had my mother and father together. You know, it's like. a home away from home. Still was there. I saw my mother, I saw my father, you know. So other than that, we had a tough time and made the best out of it. And when I read about it, like the Germans claim that the Theresienstadt was a Muster ghetto, right? Like a special type of treatment. You know what made it? The people in there, and especially the younger people, because everybody tried to keep their dignity no matter what. They still tried to learn, they still tried, they didn't know what was ahead. We all didn't know what was still ahead of us, which in a way was good, that we didn't know.
Did you have hope still at that time?
Oh, yes.
You didn't give up?
All what we were living for, to get out and go to Israel, I mean to Palestine at the time. That was our dream. So.
Do you remember, during your time, were there visitors from other countries, or the Red Cross?
Yeah, the Red Cross was there, and the Red Cross from Sweden, I think, was it the Swedish Red Cross was there. And they fixed up the ghetto ahead of time. They were expecting company.
What did it look like? How did they fix it up?
They cleaned 2-3 streets over there in one particular center that was very close where the youth organization, I mean the youth homes were. And they taught us in the Landwirtschaft. They actually trained us for days for that. They put fruit and stuff in the baskets, and we had to march into the ghetto and were filmed in ghetto from, what was his name, a Jewish film regisseur who came from Berlin. His name was Geron, and he took the films from Theresienstadt. He didn't make out either. After that, he went to Auschwitz. This is right after that all the transport started.
Were you allowed to eat that food?
We were allowed to eat that food, and they taught us what to say. They said, oh, don't we have anything else to eat? We always have to eat the same thing. Don't you have something this time? Couldn't you bring in, let's say, for instance, strawberries instead of apples, you know? I don't know exactly the words anymore, but that's what they taught us.
But at least you were able to eat some apples.
Didn't help much for the one day.
But at the time, do you remember it? Particularly that?
No, I just remember that we walked in there with the things in there and they took that film.
Did they give you different clothes to wear? Did they dress you up in any way?
No, we had usually in the summer times we had like, we made from, mostly from bed sheets and stuff. We made our own clothes. And some people who could sew, we had like slacks, shorts. And in the winter time, I don't know, we had very little clothes, but we made the best out of it. That was still a ghetto life.
But when they were trying to fix the place up to make everything look very nice.
Yeah. Oh, they made like a children pavilion where the kids could play and all kind of things.
Did they let you wear makeup or did they fix your hair?
No, nothing like that. Not that I remember.
They just cleaned
most,
up the street?
Most of us had short hair anyway because of lice and etc. in the beginning there.
So, but you remember them cleaning the street?
Yes, they cleaned the street. They had the, what did they call it? The Straßenkolonne. There were people who had to clean the streets up and fixed up some of the buildings from the outside. Just for the Red Cross.
Was there music also?
Yeah, they had a ghetto music. They had a ghetto ghetto band play music and I believe at that time they had what they called a cafe house. They made like people could sit outside in the park area, you know, in a plaza type of thing. But this was like nothing. It was a joke.
And as soon as the Red Cross left,
everything
what would
was
happen?
Gone. Everything was gone again. Everything was gone. It was the same. Right after the thing was when the Red Cross came and did the filming, the transport started again. Eichmann came. I saw Eichmann many times in Theresienstadt, and as soon Eichmann came, you knew there was a transport going, or more. Than
what
one.
Did he look like?
You know how I remember him? A short, not tall, a short man in uniform. I understand that his family lived at one time as missionaries in Palestine. And what happened is that he approached some of the people and spoke Hebrew to them, because he lived in Palestine as a child or as a young man. Yeah, but he was known for what he was. Everybody was knew when he came there was something was going on.
We're going to have to stop now again and resume in just a minute or two with tape number 5. This is tape number 5. My name is Joe Barbaro. The survivor is Marion Gottesman. Today's date is June 26, 1996. Is there anything else you'd like to tell me about the life in the ghetto in Theresienstadt before we continue?
Well, let's put it this way, that the young people try to still educate themselves, have education from people who had educations already, who taught us, and there were a lot of Jewish musicians. There were opera singers, Jewish opera singers, and they still put performances together, even so they were not supposed to. They did it in hidden places. And they tried to make, even in the ghetto, a cultural life, if possible.
Did you go to some of those concerts?
Yes, I did. I did. I had a friend who was playing at the Requiem, played the Requiem, and he was in an orchestra, and for rehearsals I went with him in the basement somewhere, I remember. I know a girl who is in Florida. She played Maria Stewart in Maria Stewart, and she was only 15 or 16 years old at that time. She had a fantastic voice and was a very good actress at the time already. She was from Berlin.
Do you remember her name?
Yes, but I don't know if they want me to mention names. Her name was Liane Pick. Actually, there were two sisters, Liane and the other one was, I forgot her name. Both of them were playing in there, but Liane had the main lead. There also was a, from Maria Stewart, I believe there is a Mortimer in there, and the boy was from Hamburg, and I believe he's a professor in California now. It's an older man now, two already. And they try to make still culture in the ghetto. And I feel that whatever they say about Theresienstadt, that is supposed to be, was supposed to be such a better ghetto than the other ones, what made it better were the people in it, because they tried to keep dignity, and it helped.
Let's talk about leaving Theresienstadt. When did it happen, first of all?
I believe it happened around the 3rd of October, 1944. We got to Auschwitz in the 6th of October, so it must have been like 3-4 days before that.
Did you know where you were going?
We had no idea. Honestly, we had no idea. They had told us that there are labor camps around the Leipzig-Dresden area, which is not that far from, you know, on the German side of the border instead of the Czechoslovakian. And we always heard about Riesa, which Riesa happened to be a town in, is that Sachsen up there? I don't know. And they always said that people from the ghetto going to Riesa. For what reason, who brought that up, I have no idea. So we thought we're going either to another ghetto or we have to work in Lisa or whatever. Landed up in Auschwitz.
Did you go with your parents?
I went with my mother and father together.
How did you go there? How were you transported?
Before I answer that, my mother and father were in the transport. I was not at that particular time. But I went anyway. I just took my things and I went to the...
How did that happen?
What?
You were not supposed to go? But
I was not... I don't know if I wasn't supposed to go. I was not in that particular transport. I was not called in to go at that with that transport to Auschwitz. But being that my mother and father were in there, I wanted to go with them. I didn't know where I was going. And luckily I did, because I think that had something to do that my mother and I got out together. Saved our lives.
How were you allowed to join the transport if you were...
You were not allowed to do anything. You just did, because with all those people around there, standing there with a little knapsack, not knowing what's happening, there were thousands of people in those transports. They didn't count you. They didn't ask your name. So I just went with them. I wasn't asked the name or anything. I just went on.
That's went on what? What did you go on? How were you transported?
Well, first we had to, like, a Sammelkaserne, like a place, collecting place in the ghetto. And from there they put us right there. By then they had already the trains expanded from Bauschwitz to Theresienstadt for the past year and a half before that. And right from that caserne you went onto the cattle trains, with the SS standing there and the dogs already and etc.
Cattle cars?
Cattle cars.
Yeah. How many per car?
Full of people. Some could sit down, some were standing up. No air, nothing to eat. I think the minute we were in those cars, we knew this was it. That was the last thing. I believe that.
You thought the end was near?
That I think, and every one of us, and you know, the train ride from Theresienstadt to Auschwitz is something nobody can explain. You really can't.
I'm going to ask you to try anyway.
No, I can't. I mean, you can't explain it. You can't. It's impossible.
How long did it take, first of all?
I think 3 days, something like 3 days nights, something like that.
And you were never allowed to get out of the car.
Couldn't get out. You had no facilities. You had the cars were closed, no air coming in, you couldn't go to any bathroom. It was horrendous. Okay? That was the trip.
Were there guards in the car itself?
The guards, I believe, was on top of the cars, and then they had like those little wagons between the cattle cars where they were in.
And each car had people from all ages, young?
No, it actually were all my parents' age and children, and my age. At that time, I was 17.
So. And they didn't give you anything to eat or
nothing
drink?
Nothing to eat, nothing to drink, no place to relieve yourself. I mean, it was like Dante's Inferno. Then already.
So how did people relieve themselves? How?
Just went. I mean, it's
there was no.
It's
pail
something. You
or anything?
Something when you think back of it, you can't really talk about it and explain, because it's the worst.
There was no pail.
Nothing.
To use? No bucket.
Nothing. Nothing. Not that I know. Nothing.
Could you lie down?
No. Standing up for 3 days.
Why couldn't you lie down?
Because the wagons were so full of people that you could. A few people who went on first maybe sat down, and everybody was tumbling on top of each other. Just.
What did the people talk about?
I don't know. I really don't know. I really don't know. You heard a lot of crying. You heard people talking to each other, whispering to each other, holding each other. It was like something you cannot remember. You don't want to remember. I think that as bad as everything happened afterwards, I think there was the worst. That was the worst.
Did some people die in the cattle car?
I believe so, yes.
What would happen to them? What, their bodies?
Nothing. The bodies were there, and when we got off the train, when they got us out of the train, they took the bodies out, and that was it. I have no idea, any idea what happened afterwards to other people than to ourselves.
Do you remember the smell, the odor?
Oh, incredible. It was terrible. Terrible, terrible.
Is it something you could get used to after a while? And that it was not offensive?
I don't know if you get, of course it's offensive, of course you cannot get used to it, but you don't not have a way out.
Did anyone try to get out of the car?
We were banging on the doors. You know, they stopped the trains and said, I guess, in the middle of the roads going up there or in the station, we couldn't even look out. Nobody opened up for us. That was it.
And there was no window even?
No windows, small window? Nothing. Nothing.
Nothing?
Nothing.
Totally dark?
No, that's cattle cars. You know where they have the, where the cattle cars.
So the cattle cars finally stopped.
Stopped.
And the...
And you heard a lot of screaming from the SS. And a lot of... Then they open up the thing. Juden raus, whatever.
What does that mean?
Means like Jews should get out. There was nobody else there anyway, right? Jews... And we got out of there, and they put us in lines. And then there was an SS man standing there with a revolver in his hand. And he took my father on one side. You know, he pointed from one side to the other. He didn't talk, he pointed.
With a revolver he was pointing?
Yeah, with his hand and the revolver like that. So over to the left was to the left. Little did we know what the left or the right was. And over to the right was the right. So my father went to the left. My mother went to the left, and I went to the right. And my mother got out of the line in front. At that time, we didn't know who it was, but it was Mengele. And right in front of Mengele, with the revolver in his hand, started screaming at him, not he, at her.
Your mother screamed
at
him?
My mother screaming at him, "You just took my husband away, who was fighting for you, for your fatherland." I remember exactly the words, I mean, I have to translate it in my head. "For your fatherland in 1914-18. My daughter you don't take away from me. Either she goes with me or I go with her." We didn't know what is what, right? So he looked at my mother and he said, "How old are you?" And my mother said something like 45, I think she was 46, 47, something. So, with, "How old is your daughter?" So she made me automatically older, right? She said something like 1920. So she said, "All right, go on that side." So my mother got on the side where I was. And that's how we got through. That we got into a, not knowing we would get through. We didn't know what was happening to us.
But you were separated from your father. Your
we
father
were separated
stayed.
From my father, yes.
And your mother went to
and
on
my,
your side.
My mother went then on my side, and we walked through a camp into some barracks, which turned out to be a sauna. And
turned out to be what?
A sauna, you know, like what they call a sauna, like a cleansing place, whatever. And that's where they shaved our heads and our body hair and took everything away from us. And
let me go back to your mother speaking out against this guard who later turned out to be Mengele. Were people surprised that?
I don't know.
Someone like would.
He must have been very surprised. That's for sure. He must have been very surprised. But people were in such a daze. What was going on? Because we really didn't know what was going on.
Were you scared for your mother? Did you think something?
I wasn't scared for my mother. I was very scared for my father. Because I didn't know when my mother went on the left side, what would happen. But then when they put my mother with me together, I said, "All right, at least we are together. But what's going to happen to Papa?" You know, like that. That was it. He was 50 years old at that time.
50?
Yeah. He had his 50th birthday still in the ghetto.
It was very courageous of your mother to...
Yeah, my mother, I think I mentioned it to you before, a very, very courageous woman. Very. And this is not the last we saw of Mengele. We had an experience with him right there before the war ended.
Tell me about it now.
Where we got into Auschwitz, as I told you, and then later on we were selected to a labor camp, and we landed up as Außenkommando, a subsidiary of Groß Rosen, and which was called Merzdorf. And in March 45, Mengele must have gotten from Auschwitz, was liberated in January, so he must have gotten before that to Groß Rosen, not knowing to us, we didn't know. And we had a morning appel, you know, like take the count, etc. And what happened is, here comes this SS man, which we didn't see before there, with whole staff of people. And my mother and I were like in the first row, in the center. And he stopped in front of my mother, and my mother had, I mean, she looked bad already when we went to Auschwitz, but forget it. After that, I mean, that was a little skinny, tiny woman, you know, no hair, etc. And he stopped in front of my mother and he looked at her and he said, "You only have to thank me that you are still alive, that you and your daughter are still alive." So he recognized my mother and me after all that. So which I, in my mind, believed that there were not many people who did that. It must have left an impression somehow or the other.
You probably remembered that forever.
Right.
Let's go back to Auschwitz.
Right.
You went through some type of cleansing,
yes.
Showers.
That's what they called cleansing. Actually, it was another selection, because there were some people who were taken away right at the time. You know, we had to get completely undressed, got our hair shaven, etc., head shaven, body hair, etc. And then there were some, which I don't know if they were other SS doctors or whatever they were, but they were officers, and they looked us up and down and took some of the people on the side. And my mother was on that side again, on the opposite side.
Separated from you?
Separated from me. And I got out from my line and told my mother, "Here we are, completely naked, no hair, no nothing." I said, "Mama, they wouldn't recognize you anyway. Go in the back of the line again." And whatever happened, she got through that time.
She got through?
She got through on the line where I was. The others were taken away.
So she snuck back
to yourself.
So she
snuck back into the line where I was, right? But not directly behind me, on the end of the line. And she got through. So most likely there was another SS doctor or another SS man or woman, whatever, and saw her and didn't recognize that she went through that line already.
And what happened to the line that she was on that she left?
I believe that they went right into the gas, because there were people who had scars on their body. And my mother had gone through, when she was young, a lot of surgeries. And I guess that's what the reason that they put her on that side.
The younger people were on the line that you were on?
Yeah.
And the older, sicker people?
No, not old. The people weren't old in that particular people we were with. They were like maybe my mother's age, let's say between 45 and 50, which maybe sounded old for me then.
And you were about how old now?
I was 17. I was 17 at the time.
Were there other teenagers?
17? Oh, yeah, a lot of them. And a few of us got through and made it alive and still meet as good friends here in the States.
Were the men separated from the
women?
The
men were separated from the women. And
when they shaved you, did they use an actual razor blade
shaver? You know, like the razors, like the old German type of razors they had.
So you were shaven like completely,
completely
to skin?
To the skin.
Nothing. No hair at all?
Nothing.
All parts of your body?
All parts of your body.
In front of the German troops?
Of course. Man, everybody was there.
Was there
was the it was such a shock that you get like, you're totally helpless. You don't, it, and still you didn't know what was ahead of you.
Was there any feeling left of trying to be modest and feel embarrassed to be naked in front of?
I don't
Were there any
so.
Feelings like that? Or was there hopelessness?
The only thing I remember that some women said it's a good thing that their husbands don't see them that way. That I remember how people acknowledged the fact what happened.
Were the women screaming at this time?
No. It was like quiet, mute. Nobody said a word. You were like, I can't explain, it was almost like hypnosis, you know? You had nothing left in you to live for. And then they gave us in another room, they gave us some clothes to wear. Not our clothes, some clothes.
What did it look
so
like?
I landed up with those, you know, like they looked like the Dutch wooden shoes, and a skirt and a jacket. No, a dress and a jacket. And the dress was all torn up and dirty, you know, and was open in front. No underwear, okay? And a jacket which was unbelievably nice. Essentially, I had it for one day. A warm jacket on top of it, you know, it was October. Could have used a warm jacket. So here I was standing in the wooden shoes, in that dress. I don't know how long it was. I guess now it was torn up to here. You could see everything. So I bit into the material to make a hole and ripped a piece out and bit holes in here to tie it together. Okay? Then I had that nice jacket. We get to the barracks where we, you know, were put in, and they had the carpos, etc. And I don't even think it took a day. The carpo took my jacket. So here I was without a jacket and a dress with holes in. And that's how I got out of Auschwitz.
What was your mother wearing? What kind of clothes did she have?
We all had the same type of, like we would say in Jewish, alte Schmattes, and torn and dirty.
Which means what? Rags?
Rags.
They weren't official uniforms?
No, not uniforms. Most likely from other prisoners, the clothes, which was very old already, or used by some and taken off when there were guests, who knows?
Did you have a hat to cover your head at all?
No, nothing. Nothing. Nothing at all.
What did it look like? What do you remember?
How we looked?
Looking at the other people, thinking...
All of a sudden I felt we all looked
realizing
alike.
Realizing how you looked.
Yeah, we all looked alike. I mean, I was... when I got to Auschwitz, into the sauna there, what I call the sauna, there were people who I knew. Once the hair was off, you didn't know people anymore. You didn't even maybe recognize them by the eyes, but that's all.
Did they shave the eyebrows too?
No. Not that I remember, no. Just the head and every other hair.
Underneath the arms?
Yeah, underneath the arms and the rest the of
pubic
the
pubic area?
Yeah.
Were any of the women molested by the German soldiers? Was there any type of sexual abuse?
If there was, I didn't notice, I'll be honest. I don't know. I really don't know. I'm sure that was going on, but I don't know.
You didn't see it? You didn't
No. At that particular time, all you thought of, what's next?
What did the barracks look like that you were taken to now? Now you were dressed, you had beautiful clothes on.
Barracks with wooden barracks with a roof. And you went in, and there was like in the middle of a barrack, I believe there must have been horse barracks at one time, you know, like for horses and animals. In the middle was like a walkway, a higher walkway, this way the SS ran back and forth. On each side of them were what we called coverlets, which the bunk beds, right? There were five on top of each other.
Five levels?
Five levels. No straw or covers or anything, just the wood. And that way we were on five people at a time on each
No mattress?
No mattress, no covers, no nothing.
Pillow?
Nothing. Nothing.
Blanket?
Nothing. Nothing. Just us.
This was cold, wasn't it? This
was bitter cold. It was very cold, and it was in Poland. It was very cold there.
How did you keep warm?
I don't know. I don't know. I have no idea. I'm now being very cold and very hungry and very dirty and feeling my head. Where's my hair?
Did your mother stay next to you on the bunk?
My mother and I, we were together all the time. We huddled together. Maybe that kept us warm.
How did you pass the time in the barracks?
Being afraid, because by then we knew, when we saw the smoke from the chimneys, that there were extermination gas ovens. Being afraid from one minute to the other, now they take us. Because it was like a period of just waiting and doing nothing. Once a day they took us to the, what they called the latrine, you know, to the
bathrooms.
And that's one day a girl approached me. If I have a piece of bread to give her, she would give me a knife, and I still have the knife today. And
you gave her a piece of bread?
I gave her my bread.
Why?
And she gave me that. I wanted a knife. Don't ask me why. But I had a knife. I was the big shot. I had a knife. Nothing to cut with. Right? And
but if you were so hungry, why did you give up the bread?
I don't know. I don't know. I thought maybe with a knife I could save my life. I don't know.
Did your mother know that you did this?
Yeah, of course. She was right next to me. Everything happened together to us. From that minute on, everything happened together.
How did the day pass? What did you do?
Well, in the morning was a appel, which took for hours, standing in the cold, freezing, till the SS came, counted and counted and counted again. Just let us stand out there. And the rest of the time you were in the barrack, wondering what the next hour brings. You were looking ahead to get our soup once a day.
That's all you were fed once
all,
a day?
What we got. And
how much soup?
We personally, I never talked about it, I didn't even write about it when I wrote it. We had a terrible experience. We had a soup next to us in a big bucket. I don't even know how we ate it. And really now, I don't remember all that. Just now one thing, there must have been the third or fourth day in Auschwitz. There was a finger in there with a ring. I have never, ever talked about it to anybody.
There was a human finger?
A human finger with a ring in it.
And you ate the soup?
I guess we ate the soup. I don't know. But I remember that was, we were the five girls from us on, maybe sleeping on that bank together, we were like in shock for days. I mean, you know, these are things which you really bury so deep down you don't even want to talk about it. But it happened. That happened.
Who was the capo in your barracks? Do you remember the name?
No, we didn't know any names from anybody. That didn't exist, that we knew names. We didn't know any names.
Was the capo Jewish?
We had a Ukrainian capo, which was very bad. And we had a Jewish capo, I believe, there. We didn't really know what they... I know one was the Ukrainian because she had a different... they were in uniform, right? They had the striped suits and the hats and everything on. And the Ukrainian had a red triangle on, so we knew that she was a political or whatever. Turned out she was Ukrainian, but she was bad, really bad.
What did she do that was bad?
Screaming and hitting and pushing, and I think she's the one who took my jacket anyway, so that was bad enough for me. And the other one was a Jewish couple, but I don't know if any of these people even survived, because they were there much longer than us, and stayed much longer than us, and I'm sure they were gassed anyway, or went on a death march.
Were you personally beaten at all in Auschwitz?
I don't remember. It was so bad that I really, really don't remember.
How about your mother? Was she treated? How was she treated?
My mother, that's another thing, coming back from the appel into the barrack, she got out of line and she ran to the electric wire and she wanted to kill herself. And just before she got to it, I had pulled her back. So it was Auschwitz. And 2 days later, they came and selected us for the labor camp.
Did you know your mother was going to try to run to the fence?
No. I just saw her running towards that, and that was it.
Did you talk about it afterwards to your mother?
No. We never spoke about it, ever. Not even here. We never talked about that.
We're going to have to take another break now.
Okay.
And we'll resume in just a moment.
It's a long story.
This is tape number 6. Today's date is June 26, 1996. My name is Joe Barbaro. The survivor is Marion Gottesman, and we're in Rego Park, New York. But we were talking about Auschwitz.
Right.
And that's where I'd like to start again.
But there's not so much to talk about it anymore, except that waiting around, which I told you already, and the story about my mother I told you too. And the only other thing was one day was appel and it took 200 people, and they counted out 5 by 5. We were 100 people, not 200 people. We were 100 people, and we were in a row of 95, then came 100, and the rest of them stayed, and they took us and walked us to another sauna again. And on that walk, walking from that one camp into the other one, all I could think of is, now we're going to go into the gas.
Let me go back. How long were you in Auschwitz, approximately?
Approximately between 2 and 4 weeks. I don't know exact time, because there was no time for us there.
I wanted to ask, how did you keep track of time?
We didn't. This is why I never know how long I was in Auschwitz, because you live from one appel to the other, from one whatever you could eat when they gave us something to eat, and that was it. And you lose complete track of day, night, and everything else.
What were you thinking about your father? What happened to him? Is this something that was on your minds during that time?
We didn't want to acknowledge it. We did not want to acknowledge it that the people, like my father, I mean, to me he was still a young man, he was 50 years old, right? That they would kill people like that, on the spur of the moment, taking them off the train right into the gas. But that would happen. I mean, all that acceptance, I believe, came later of that. But knowing that there were the ovens burning, and you did see from a distance the smokes and etc., and had an idea what was going on. That's what I come to now, because when they took us from the 100 of us and took us to another sauna, which we cleaned in place, that walk I will never forget, because I thought, this is it. We're going to be gassed. And I remember exactly what, and I still talk about it to my friends, what I felt. I felt, all right, when it happened, it happened. It's not me alone. I'm with my friends and with my mother. That was my own, you know, feeling. It wouldn't matter because I was not alone. I didn't think of how it was done, or there was no after anymore. It was just a fact, now we're going to die. And then it was a surprise. They took us through the sauna again, gave us some different clothes. I don't remember exactly what it was. Maybe a little bit warmer, I don't know. Still with the wooden shoes. And they brought us to the train station. And over there I had another experience. I ran into two girls, they were twins, who were what they called in Auschwitz Läuferin, meaning they were sent from one barrack to the other to take care of the capos, doing things for the capos. And I don't know, one was called Schreiberin and the other one was a Läuferin, whatever that meant over there. And those two girls were with us in Theresienstadt together and had come to Auschwitz a few weeks before us. But there also was, which we didn't know at the time, under control from Mengele with experiments, etc. And when they saw me and when they saw the other girls, which they knew, we were like quite a few girls there together, which, you know, we were all together in Theresienstadt. One of them came and brought me a scarf to put around my neck or head or whatever. I met them again here in New York. And one of them committed suicide right here in New York. She was married and had children, and she committed suicide. I think it must be about 15, 20 years ago. And the other one lives in Boston. So I guess it had the after effects.
Tell me again, in Auschwitz, how did you know that the chimney and the smoke going
when
up...
When we were walking into the camp, we had guards next to us. And first of all, what I remember, I didn't mention it before, there was like behind the wires, there was one place, all you saw were children carriages, baby carriages. And I asked the guard next to me, I said, how come there are so many carriages? So they said, very easy, because all the children went into the gas. And this is most likely where you land up to. That's how I know that they were gassed. And then somebody told us the chimneys, when you see the chimneys burning, that's where the people are. That's how we knew. And then I saw the same thing like with the carriages, the baby carriages. We saw one place, all walking in to the barracks. One big place, only with shoes. That was in the open, you know, they had them all collected and was like sent away or did things with it, I don't know.
How many shoes?
Thousands. Thousands. Like if you would have a baseball field, right, full of shoes. That's how it looked to me.
All gathered together?
All gathered together. Mountains of
piled
shoes.
Piled up high?
Mountains of shoes. Mountains of baby carriages. This is how I know. That's what I remember walking in.
Did you know where the gas chambers were?
We didn't really know, but they taught us when you see the smoke from the chimneys, this is where they burn the people. That's how we knew when we saw the chimney smoking. That was it.
Did you know any names of the commanders of the camp?
No, not at that time.
Or the guards?
No, none. Till we found out that Mengele was the one.
When did you find out it was Mengele?
I believe it was in Merzdorf. I don't think we knew before, because when he came that time and he recognized my mother and me, and we were working, and you know this was a factory where we were, and we even slept in the factory. They had two floors. One floor was for the SS and one floor was for us, right? And then we were behind doors and gates and things like that at night. They locked us in. And one of the guards there, I don't know, my mother worked in a different place than I did. So she was working more outside than I did. I worked right in the factory. So what happened is she must have, not knowing the guard, but talked to the guard. And she asked who that SS man was, and it was Mengele.
Was his name well known already? I mean, once...
I guess so. I don't know. I mean, this is the first time that I had any knowledge of Mengele.
Oh.
Except that I saw him in Auschwitz, had the experience with him there, and later on in Mastov. But I didn't know it was the Dr. Mengele who became that famous afterwards, right?
You were mentioning you walked, you remember walking from Auschwitz to...
No, just to the, where the trains.
To the train.
To the cattle trains again.
Was that a far walk? Was it difficult, do you remember?
No, it wasn't that far. It was not really far.
You were 100?
It was...
100 women?
We were 100 women, and then there were... we were 100 women in... We were called the Czech transport, because we came from Czechoslovakia. And in the same trains, there were about three other... wagons there. There were 200, that's why I got missed, there were 200 Hungarian girls. They were in another cattle car. And then there were some men, two cars full of men. So what they did, they brought us from Auschwitz to Groß Rosen. And in Groß Rosen, they let the men out, they went to Groß Rosen. I don't know what happened to them afterwards. And the 200 Hungarian girls and us, the Czechs, we went into Mastov, not knowing where we would land up, but that's where we...
And you were in cattle cars again? Was
yeah.
it crowded?
Very.
So
I mean, take 100 people in one car.
Was it as bad as the ride to Auschwitz? How would you compare?
I think the ride to Auschwitz was worse. To me, it was
But it was
worse.
Similar? It was no bathrooms?
No bathrooms, no nothing. Except they had a little room in the cattle car where they had like a guard. And the guards were not the real SS at that time. They had already what they called the Volkssturm. We only found all that out later on, where they took the older people and trained them to be guards on those trains. And we had an older man there. And he came out not to worry. I remember that he told us not to worry that we go to a labor camp. So that much I remember.
Did you believe him when he said that?
I guess we believed him for the simple reason that we were out of Auschwitz. I got hysterical when we landed up in Groß Rosen. Because, you know, when Groß Rosen looked exactly like Auschwitz and smaller. And they had the doors open that time. So I thought, that's it. No, it took us from one place to the other to kill us. But we made it to Mastov, which is very close by anyway.
Do you remember the name of this guard?
No.
No.
Didn't know any names from anybody.
Did he have a weapon to guard?
Yeah, he had a gun. He had a gun. Like a regular
Was there
gun. You know, like all the soldiers were around.
What did you do with your knife that you had when you traded it?
Would you believe it? I had the knife with me all the time, and nobody ever found
Where
out.
Where did you hide it?
I don't know. I just must have had it on me somehow or the other. And I got it through the second sauna, and I got it on the train, and I got it to Mastov, and I still had it.
How did you get it through
And that
the
sauna? Knife went around. Then in Mastov, it was a little bit different, because not that we had so much more freedom, but we worked a lot, and the knife came handy in certain things. So I was the big shot. I had the knife. Nobody else had it.
Did you let anyone use it?
And yeah, of course. If somebody needed a knife or something or what. I remember what we cut with it. The factory was called it a flux fabric, which is the stuff they make the thread from linen in a weaver, you know, in waves. Waveries or whatever they're called, and we used to open up the flux. They're like about that white when they grow on the bushes. So when we got them in the factory to process them to make yarn from that, right? We opened it up and there were like little seeds in it, and we used to eat it. We used to eat that because it kept us going. We were always hungry. And we knew nothing could happen if we eat that. So I always had the knife with me to open up those things.
But how did you get the knife through the sauna? You had to take off all your clothes, right? To take a shower?
Right, but I really don't remember.
And you were given different clothes?
Yeah. I don't remember how I got the knife, so I have no idea anymore, but I have. One way or the other.
What kind of work did your mother do in Mersdorf?
In Mersdorf, she was working outside where they cut the flux or put them together in bundles. And I was working inside at the, I don't know what you call it, Webstuhl. Do you know what that is?
No. Continue.
Where they weave material on. That's where I worked.
Was it hard work?
It was very hard work. It was military work. We did it for the, I guess the German army needed linen, whatever.
How did you feel about being separated from your mother?
Well, that was like the working hours, and then we were together again.
How many hours did you work a day?
I don't know. Sometimes 8 hours, sometimes 10 hours, sometimes they selected us to do extra work, cleaning for the SS. We did that too. And we had to do all kinds of things. One of the girls was pregnant when she got to Auschwitz, and nobody realized that she was pregnant. It was the beginning. And she still became quite heavy, I mean, showing her pregnancy, when we were in Mersdorf, and she had her baby, and she died, and the baby died. And I don't know, from no place, they took me and 4 other girls, in the middle of the winter, it was snowing and ice, and it was terrible, right in the mountains, and we had to dig the grave, and go back to the factory, and they took us on some kind of a horse and carriage, something like that, with the coffin. They had a coffin, and we had to bury her. And her name was Elfie Ehrmann. I never will forget it. Beautiful young woman. She was married, and she had become pregnant while she was in Theresienstadt, and her husband went to Auschwitz also. And she never let on that she was pregnant, and that was it. So all kind of experiences.
Were there any punishments that affected you?
Yes. My mother fainted while we were standing uphill outside from the cordon, etc. And they took a cold water hose to revive her, but in ice and in snow. And she got very, very, very sick. So she was with a few other people who were very sick in one of the sick rooms, whatever they called it, and they had from the Polish girls we had there, the Hungarian and Polish girls, there was a woman who was a doctor, and she was like taking care of the sick people, and I still believe that she saved my mother's life.
Did she have medicine?
No medication, but somehow or the other she got my mother to come around and get better. But then my mother took second time very sick. I don't remember what she had. I guess it was weakness, really. And when we were liberated, she was in that sick room at the time.
How long were you in Mersdorf?
We were in Mersdorf from the end of October, I guess, or beginning of November, whenever we left Auschwitz, till May 8th, 1945.
So about 6 months?
Yeah, a little longer. Yeah, 6 months, 5, 6 months.
Were the conditions better or worse than Auschwitz? How would you compare?
It was better in the respect that you didn't have that continuous fear from 1 hour to the other what's going to happen, because you knew you were working, you had to work. The SS women were terrible. They were absolutely terrible. I mean, they were a terror. And it was better in the sense that you had hope maybe you're going to survive it and you're going to be liberated. And then on the last month, May, in April, we heard already shooting and bombing and things like that. So we always was under the feeling the Russians are coming closer. Maybe. Maybe we make it, you know. And we were lucky we didn't get in one of the death march because a lot of the camps from around there, they were collected and sent towards Czechoslovakia and Austria and other camps again. We made it.
Was the food better in Mersdorf?
It was better than Auschwitz, but not enough.
How many times a day did you get to eat?
You know, we get a piece of bread in the morning and something with water, coffee, I don't know what it was supposed to be. And then we got one soup. This was the standard diet for any camp, I guess.
Were the barracks similar? Were they?
No, we weren't in barracks. We were staying in the factory.
In the factory, you mentioned.
Yeah.
Was that comfortable? I mean, did you have a mattress?
What did we have there? Mattresses we didn't have, but it looked like a mattress and it was straw. You know, sewn into a piece of material or something like
that. So it was more comfortable.
So that was already a little better than Auschwitz, let's put it that way. And then what we did there is there were girls who worked like me in the weverei, right, where they make the materials and they had acid to pieces of material. So they smuggled it upstairs because we were on the last floor. And don't ask me where it came from, a needle and some yarn and some thread and things, but they're usually the girls who had different type of work than I had. And we cut the pieces of material and made us brassieres and something under clothes to wear, etc. That's it.
You mentioned the SS women were...
The men were bad, the women were worse.
What can
if
you tell
anything
me?
Can be worse than an SS man, the women were worse.
What did they do?
The screaming, the hitting, for no reason hitting, okay? They were incredible. They were unbelievably bad. And especially the one who called herself the commandant of the camp.
I think
her first name was Hertha, I'm not sure. Last name I never got. But I heard other people calling her Hertha, so, you know, from the SS. I think that was her name.
And what did she do?
She hit people. She was the one with the hose and hosed my mother up and down with ice water. And she was terrible. It was just a terror. Two girls tried to escape from Mersdorf, made it out, were hidden in a farm somewhere, and then got caught. And they brought the two girls back. What they had to go through, how they were mistreated was unbelievable. They weren't killed, I mean, that was a surprise. But how they were mistreated was unbelievable. And all the women at that particular time had already a little bit of hair growing back. So all of us got shaved again, the whole camp. That must have been like in January, February, something like that. Two Czech girls tried to escape. So there were always punishments.
What happened to these two girls when they were caught?
They were liberated with us. I don't know what happened to them afterwards.
What was the punishment that they received?
The punishment was that they were really beaten up. They were, I mean, that they were even alive when they came back was unbelievable. But
you saw them being
beaten? Yeah, they were still upstairs in the factory later on with us. And there were two girls which worked outside on the truck and somehow escaped from there. And they were away like at least 3-4 days.
Do you remember their names?
No, I don't. I could ask somebody, you know, but I forgot. I just know how they looked.
How? Tell me what they looked like.
They were originally were very pretty girls, two very pretty girls. They got very, you know, with the unshaven heads and everything, but I mean, I can picture them. I know who they were, but the names I forgot.
But after they were beaten, did they show the signs of being beaten?
Oh, yes. They were black and blue and bloody and everything else. Everything else, believe me. But I wish they could have escaped and could have made it back to Czechoslovakia. But they didn't.
Was that the only attempt that you know of?
That's the only attempt I know of, and the girls were brought back. So.
Were you mistreated in this camp?
Yes, I was hit.
Why?
Because when you're on that weaving thing, it's like a thing you have to learn. If you don't know it, how the heck would you know how to do things, right? So little by little, we had an idea how to do it. We had to know it, let's put it that way. And you put like, it's a capsule like, about that long, and you put the spule, which is the thing with the yarn, you put that inside, and then it goes automatically back and forth, right? And that opened up in the middle of it and tore the whole material apart. And that's when I got it. I was hit very badly.
Where were you hit?
In the face, on my head, on my shoulders, all over.
Who hit you?
What they called the Meister. The Meister was the one, the master from the, of the, who was actually in charge of that factory, the German.
What did he hit you with?
I think he hit me with like, what is what the police walks around with, the...
A baton?
Yeah, something like that. Like the wooden baton, something like that.
Is there anything else you want to tell me about your experience in Marsdorf?
Experiences in Marsdorf, the only experience, nice experience was when I went on the 8th of May in the morning down to my mother into the sick room, because I snuck in there every morning before I had to go to Appell and to work to see if she was still alive and all. And I'm standing in my mother's bunk bed, was right next to a window with a gate. And I had a hurry to look, we had no mirrors or anything, into that window if I could see my hair growing or whatever, right? Rain, even that time. And I look out and I see two Russian soldiers on bicycles. And I started screaming, the Russians are here, the Russians are here, we are liberated. And they all thought I got nuts. Nobody knew even that the SS was gone. They weren't in a factory anymore. They had left during the night. And we thought we had to come down for Appell and go to work. And I saw these two Russian guys on the bicycle. So I ran downstairs screaming, the Russians are here, the Russians are here. With that, they drove into the courtyard. And maybe not even a half an hour later, then the panzers and the trucks and the soldiers came in. And the first thing they did included the sick people, took us all out of the whole area, and were searching the area, and it was dynamited. It would have taken another 2-3 hours, we would have been up in the air. They had dynamite timed underneath the factory.
Who dynamited it?
The Germans, before they left. But we didn't know that, but obviously the Russians knew about it from other camps they liberated. You know, from other labor camps they liberated. So we couldn't understand why we had to leave immediately. They put us in, it was like not a park, but it was joined to a woods, you know, it was like that. And we were standing there, right? And then they came and they told us that they removed the dynamite and everything, and we went back there. And then they started slaughtering horses and cooking, and that was the first food we got.
What did they do with the horses?
They slaughtered horses. I don't know if it was their horses or the horses from farmers from over there. And they started cooking in the yard there, I remember that. And it was the first food, was horse meat.
How did it taste?
Good, believe it or not, the first meat after all these years, right?
How did you recognize the two Russian soldiers? How did you know they were Russian?
I just knew. Number one, the Russian uniforms. They had different uniforms than all the others. And second of all, they didn't look like Germans to me, that's for sure. Not that I knew what an American uniform would have been, you know. And they had, like, their heads with the red star That's how I knew it was the Russians.
Were they friendly to?
Very friendly. They took I have to say that they took very good care of all of us there. No way about it.
Do you
and
remember the names of any of the Russian liberators?
No. Don't.
How did it feel finally to be liberated?
It was unbelievable. It really was unbelievable. And then a lot of the German people who lived around that area all of a sudden came, brought us clothes and brought us food and wanted us to stay with them because they were afraid of the Russians. And then from the state, I think in March, of maybe another 4 or 5 days, something like that. And we went to Landeshut, which is the next town.
Why did you go there?
Because we found out, I don't know how, that there was a French prisoner of war camp there. So we figured we go there and maybe can go more west with them. So we went to Landeshut, and it turned out that the we stayed a few days in the prisoner of war camp there. And then somehow or the other in the surrounding over there were a lot of labor camps, so all of a sudden all these Jewish prisoners, women and men, showed up. And they somehow or the other must have been directly in the Landeshut area because they knew their way around, so they got us apartments.
We're going to have to stop now and continue again in just a moment. This is tape number 7. My name is Joe Bobro. Today is June 26, 1996. The survivor is Marion Gottesman. We were talking about your experience being liberated and what it felt like. Can you tell me a little more about it?
It felt great. Felt wonderful to think that you're free and you can do what you want. It took us a very long time to get back to what was called then later on the western part of Germany. But we made our way to Landeshut because we heard that there was a prisoner of war camp, like I mentioned before. And from there, there must have been a lot of smaller camps around that area, and there were a lot of survivors there. And they, somehow or the other, we were told to go to some kind of an office there. And we got an apartment. And we walked into the apartment. The Germans must have left from one second to the other, and everything still was on the table, you know. We stayed a few days, and then we went to Hirschberg. That's all in that lower Silesia area, which is called the Riesengebirge, you know, it's the mountains around there. And we ran into a lot of gypsies who were liberated. And
was there singing and dancing?
Singing and dancing and celebrating from one minute to the other to be liberated and free. We met a lot of gypsies. And in Hirschberg, I believe we were about 4 weeks. And we stayed in an apartment with a teacher of some kind, with family. He must have sent his family already before the Russians came west. And he was alone in that house. It's a very nice apartment, a nice house, I remember. And we stayed there, and we went to the Russian Kommandantur, and they gave us additional clothes and food and et cetera. And anyway, from Hirschberg, finally we made our way to, what was it called? Riesa, I mentioned that before. And Riesa is in Saxony already, not in Silesia. And we were told that in Risa is, near Risa is a town called Grimma. And in Grimma is a borderline between the Russians and the Americans. But what we didn't know by the time we got there, and the whole area was Russian. The Russian, the Americans went back all the way into Eschwege, I think was the borderline, further west near Frankfurt. So we were in a Russian zone about 3 months. We made our way to Eisenach, where we stayed a long time. And
you were together with your mother?
I was with my mother and three other inmates of ours. And we're still very good friends. The one lady is still alive. She's 96 and lives in San Francisco, and her daughter lives nearby. Her name was Sidonia Landau. And my girlfriend's name was Helga Landau at that time. Helga got married over here, and her mother had remarried here, and had quite a nice life in California. And the other one lives here in Yonkers, and I talk and hear occasionally from her.
And what's her name?
Her name is, now it's Eisenman, Edith Eisenman, and it's the, used to be Edith Stern. And we are somehow in contact. We don't see each other that much, but the contact is there. And what else? So we were in Eisenach, and then we finally had a chance to get over what they called the border to the American zone. And from there, they got us on the train, and we went right to Floto, my mother and I, and the others went to Frankfurt because they tried to find out if anybody of Edith's family came back, because she came from there, but nobody did come back. And she had brothers and sisters, so she had hoped this one of the siblings there would, you know, had survived. And so Mrs. Landau took Helga along, and they went to Bremen, because in Bremen she had Jewish relatives, which she knew stayed in Theresienstadt, and she had an idea that from Theresienstadt they would have gone right back to Bremen. So they stayed in Bremen till they came to America, and my mother and I went to Floto.
What did it look like when you came back?
It was the English zone, a lot of British soldiers, and a lot of Quakers from England were there, very good to us. And it was right near the famous Montgomery headquarters, Bad Oeynhausen. It was the Montgomery headquarters at the time. And we got there, we didn't know what to do, we got off the train, now what we gonna do, here we are, it was in the evening already. So we went to what they call the Rathaus, like the city hall, small little city hall. And sure enough, there were people there who knew us. The minute we walked in, they recognized my mother and me. And turned out that we were the only ones, survivors, who came back to Floto. Except Günther survived, but he landed up back in Holland and never made it to Floto. He never wanted to go back to Germany. So anyway, my mother and I were like the queens in Floto. Some Jews came back and survived, you know. And we tried to get in. We tried to get in touch with a woman at the time, who I believe was the nana to me when I was little. You know, when I was very little, and she always was very nice, even, you know, to the last minute. But we didn't know what happened. And we found out where she lived, and she took us in, and we stayed with her quite a while, and then my mother tried to get the house back for my grandmother, that we could move in there. But they made, from that one family house where later on the four Jewish families lived, there must have been 10, 12 families living in that house in Germany, from all over from Germany. I don't know what they did with it. And then my mother said, I don't want to go back in there. I don't even want to see the inside. So what they did, there was a small house which was owned by a Jewish man who was a widow. But he must have been quite a wealthy man in Floto at the time, before the war. And he still built this house when he had to get out of his big house. He built a small house in his garden. I don't know how he got the permission or anything. So whoever lived in there was a Nazi, so they took them out And we got that house, and we stayed in there till we came to America in 47.
When did you come to the United States?
In April 47. 1st of April 47, I arrived.
April 1st?
Mm-hmm. April 4th.
Why the United States? You were mentioning your desire to go to Palestine.
My mother had a sister living in New York, and I wanted to go to Palestine in the worst way, right? Eretz Israel. But my mother was very sick after we came back. As a matter of fact, the first year when we were in Florida, she landed up in the hospital and she was operated, and there was a lot of problems. So I knew at that time the only way you could go to Israel, it was illegal. I mean, you go over Italy and landed up in Crete or somewhere, or Cyprus, right? So anyhow, what happened is that my mother, in all the years that we were in camp, she would, any time I saw her, she said, don't forget Tante Rosa's name. Don't forget your aunt's name and your and the address from New York. By the time we were liberated, it was blank. No, absolutely no idea. So through the English Red Cross at the time in Florida, we had like a search in the Aufbau in the Jewish newspaper. We didn't know about it. Some Jewish officer must have told us that. And my aunt found us that way. And, you know, then started to correspond and et cetera, et cetera. And that's how we got to the United States.
How did you come to the United States?
One boat was not enough for us. We went on two boats. We came with a troop transports they had that time, you know, where they had the soldiers on. We left from Bremerhaven Ernie Pyle, that was the name of the boat, made it outside of England, and the boat broke down. Another boat, which was the Marion Gottesman, was on the way to Bremerhaven to pick up more DPs, stopped over there to pick us up, an open sea from one boat to the other. And then we came here. We made it to New York.
What was it like coming here?
Great.
What were your expectations? What were your
I
hopes?
Tell you something, I don't think I had big expectations. What I always was thinking, just be left alone and have peace. That's, you know, like, that what was in my mind. And I didn't know what to expect or not, really. So we came here, my aunt and some other family members didn't know, came to the boat to pick us up, took a taxi, they lived in Washington Heights, we went up the West Side Highway, and I was intrigued by the Hudson, and it's still my Hudson today, I love it. And we started to work right away because my aunt had like a contracting factory or some kind, so she put us in her factory. My mother worked there for some time, and I met some girls who came before me. And they were working in the custom jewelry business. There was one Jewish man from Czechoslovakia who had opened up a big custom jewelry place. And he went actually to the boats to pick the girls up to get them right to work at the time. And through those girls I met, I started to work there. And I worked there till I got till I got married, and after I got married, I worked a time in Macy's. I became pregnant, and I had my daughter.
What was the name of this man that had the custom jewelry factory?
I should remember his name. I don't remember. And now the company was called R&H Original.
R&H Original?
Yeah, R&H Original. It was a custom jewelry factory. And it was on... where the library is the library on 42nd Street, the big one, right near there. So that was
what was your husband's name?
My first husband was Harry Sternberg. I was married to him the first year when I came to the United States. I met him right away. And
how did you meet him?
At a Jewish dance. First dance I went to. I mistook him for somebody. I thought he was somebody else. And then I asked his name, and he said, no, that's not my name, but my name is this and this. I thought it was somebody I knew from camp. And he lived in the same neighborhood I lived that time, and, you know, one thing led to the other, and I got married after 8 months. It was in December 47. I came in April, and no, even shorter. And in December I got married, and my daughter was born in 1950.
What was your daughter's name?
Edna.
And what did he do for a living, your first husband?
He was actually an artist. He was a painter, but he worked in sign painting. And then after that he had a job in an engineering company, draftsman. That's what he did.
Was he a survivor also?
He also was a survivor. He was in Riga. He was from Germany and came back from Riga.
Was your mother still alive during this
time? Oh, yeah, sure.
Did she live with you?
Pardon me?
When you were married, where was your mother?
My mother and I had a furnished room. Then I got married, and my husband and I moved into a furnished room. Those years was very hard to get apartments. And then my mother stayed there, and then she got herself a little apartment by herself. And she worked very hard here all the time. And then for a while she moved upstate New York, and she was working there. And then she met her second husband, and she remarried here. I was very, very happy.
And what was the husband's name?
Heldenmuth, Alfred Heldenmuth. He was Jewish, and he had gone to England. Actually, he and his first wife and his daughter, who was at the time, I think, not even a year old, were under St. Louis, that famous boat to Cuba, and were returned, but they made it to England.
How old was your mother at the time that she married for the second time?
Well, I think she was about 56, 56, 57, yeah.
And she stayed married?
And she stayed married till he died. He was 79. He was a few years older than her. And but they were married 20 years, something like that. And my mother and him lived in Florida the last few years there. And then my mother stayed in Florida. And then when she got older, she was by then older already anyway, but when she was about 81, 82, she came back to New York, and I had an apartment here in the building for her. She lived on the fourth floor, so I took care of her to the rest. I didn't want her to go, she wanted to go in the home, but I wouldn't put her in the home, because I felt that was not for her after what she went through. So between my second husband had passed away, I remarried in 1960.
What was your second husband's name?
George Gottesman. And I knew him already as a kid in Theresienstadt. We were not boyfriend and girlfriend, but we knew each other.
Is this the one whose father?
Pardon me?
Is this the one who had a father that you knew?
That's right. His father was the one who was the
Because you mentioned your father-in-law.
Yeah, they came from Vienna. They are from Wien.
And what kind of work did he do?
He was a film editor. He was a cameraman. He became he studied after the war film business. And he became a cameraman for Wien Film. And when he came here, he became an editor. And he worked for two places here. First was Criterion Film Labs, and then he worked for TVC. And he passed away, he had a heart attack, he was 50 years old. He was very young when he died.
How many years were you married to him?
We were together about 22 years, and we were married shortly of 20 years. Most of those things.
And how did your life continue after that?
After he died? Well, that's when my mother came back. Shortly after, a year later, she came back to New York, so I took care of my mother. And then after my mother died in 1983, it was hard in one way for me, because it was right after my husband died, and there was a big shock, because he never was sick. So that's when my mother came here and kept me busy. And then after that, I don't know, it was very hard to adjust to everything, but I think I'm doing all right. I think I did. With the help of my daughter, thanks God for her.
How old is your daughter now?
oh, I have to give away her age. She's going to kill me. She's 46.
And what is she doing?
She's working for 9X since after college, her first job after college, and she's working there for 25 years already. So she had lived by herself for a long time, and then after my husband died, she also had an apartment here in the building. So actually we had three apartments, mine, my mother's, and Edna's. So what happened is afterwards, she said, look, this is ridiculous. Let's try to move together. I said, it never will last. But it did.
And how many years are you living together?
17 years or no.
Did she marry?
No, no.
Is she your only child?
It's my only child.
And what are you currently doing now?
Still surviving from one day to the other. Try to make the best out of everything.
How do you spend your time?
Well, I have the apartment to take care of. She is here. She's a lot of friends coming in and out. I have a lot of friends, and I keep myself busy. Never bored, to put it that way.
What are your interests or hobbies?
Well, I love jazz. I don't think you hear that much from a survivor. And I like art, and I like museums, and have my friends, and do things, and read a lot, and that's it.
Why do you think you survived?
Pure luck. Mazel, like they say in Jewish. Nothing else. That's what I think. And I think it's for everybody. I mean, like my mother, she survived all this. And, all right, she had the courage to survive. But that she really survived was also luck. It's fate. Nothing else. Nothing else. So we made it.
What wisdom can you pass on to future generations based upon what you went through and what you've seen?
Well, I had the big hope that there never will be any wars anymore and people would get along. But obviously I was very wrong. And it started already being wrong when I came here. The first thing was the Korean War, then it was the Vietnam War, then the Middle East, and now in Yugoslavia. And the history repeats itself at all times. Maybe in different ways, but it does. And I don't care who they are and what the people are. Nobody ever should have gone through again what we went through, but obviously people didn't learn from it. Countries didn't learn from it, let's put it that way. So I don't know where the wisdom is there, it's just you only can hope and you only can live from one day to the other.
Are you an optimist?
Yes. I think, well, I get pessimistic at times like everybody else, but in general, I think I was forced to become an optimist, otherwise I wouldn't be here.
How has the Holocaust experience affected the way you raised your own daughter?
Well, first of all, I was married to two men and both were survivors. So the subject was always there. It was never hidden, it was always there. My mother was alive, so we were talking about it. It was never hidden for my daughter. So she grew up with that, and I think it's a healthy way because it didn't affect her, I think. You can ask her later on. But I don't think it affected her like a lot of children of survivors which, you know, grew up with not knowing and then found out later on. So I think the best thing is to be open for everything in life. And I think that affected her in a way to understand. Right?
Is there anything else you want to say or to add?
Well, let's put it this way. I give thank you for Mr. Spielberg and his terrific crew of people who make everything known to the whole world and for the future. That's all I can say.
I want to thank you very much for your important contribution and your testimony.
Thank you.
Thank you. Marion, can you please introduce us to the person on your right?
Yes, the person to the right is my daughter, Edna. Her name is Edna Renee Sternberg, or known as Edna Renee Sternberg Gottesman. And she's a terrific girl.
Is there anything special you want to say to her?
Yeah, I'm very glad to have her around. I don't think I would have made the last few years without her. See, now you make me cry.
Edna, would you like to say something to your mother?
Yes. What can I say to my mother? I love her very much, and I'm very proud of her and my family for getting through what they went through. And I think it made a big difference in my life, too. Because, I think because of what they went through, it changed my outlook on life. And made me a person who I feel I'm not prejudiced because of what they went through. And I think it, in a way, did make me a better person all around. That's all.
I want to thank you both very much again for contributing to this project.
Okay.
This is my father, Willie Silverback, and it was taken during the First World War between 1914 and 18. I don't know where the picture is taken, what country, if it was in Germany or in France. I have no idea. This is a picture of me to the left. I was about 2.5, 3 years old. And to the right, the boy is was my best friend. I grew up with a Jewish boy from the town where I come from. And his name was Günter Katz. To the left on the picture is me. I must be about 2.5, 3 years old. And to the right is Günter Katz, my long life friend. I grew up with him, and this was in my hometown.
What was the name of the town?
Floto.
In which country?
Germany. To the left, it's me, my first school day in 1933, and to the right is my grandmother, Rebecca Silverberg, and it was taken in her house in Floto in Germany. This picture is taken in Herford in Germany. It's a Jewish school in 1939, approximately. And to the right is Mr. Levine, who was the teacher. And then there is Manfred Heinemann, Walter Heinemann, Ilse Schönthal, Marianne Gottesman, me. And then is Hannelore Frank, Miriam Rosenthal, Claire Franke, Eva Rosenthal, Thekla Schiff, and Marianne Heinemann. And this is taken, like I said before, in 1939. This is my father to the left and me to the right. It's my favorite picture of my father and me, and I think it's approximately taken in between 1938 and 1940. I don't really remember when. And it was taken in Floto, my hometown in Germany.
And what is your father's name?
My father's name is Willy Silverberg. There's my mother, Henny Silverberg, and me as a little girl. And it was taken in Floto, I believe it must have been in 1934-35. To the left on the picture is my mother. She was about 47, 48 years old in Floto. Next to her is Avrom Glück, who originally came from Vienna but was in the Jewish Brigade. Next to that is me. And next to me is Otto Steiner, who was a Czech guy who was with us in camp together, but after the war also was in the Jewish Brigade. And it was taken in Floto in 1940 6. This is me and my daughter Edna, and it was taken in a children's camp up in the Catskills in 1958.
What state was this taken in?
New York, in the Catskills. I think it was in Pine Bush. On this picture you see my husband, George Gottesman, and my daughter, Edna Sternberg Gottesman. It was taken on the day of the centennial in New York Harbor, and it's really my favorite picture.
When was this taken?
I don't know what year was that. This picture was taken on my mother's 85th birthday in Tarrytown, New York. And we had a little celebration for her 85th birthday shortly after that she passed away.
And her name again?
And her name is Henny Silverbeck. And she had remarried here in the United States and became Henny Heldenwood. This knife is from Auschwitz. I had a piece of bread and I exchanged it with another woman, and she gave me the knife, and I got it from Auschwitz to Merzdorf and to America.
I want to thank you very much for sharing these wonderful photos and memorabilia with us and your important contribution to this project.